Okay, guys, are we ready? Be ready for 3 hours, Paul. Get a move on. Okay. Right, guys. Welcome. Thank you. I'm starting. Welcome to the Free North West Critical Mass Show Conference. Sorry, it's been a bit delayed. Things sort of changed at last minute. Free North West Critical Mass Radio, what we're on now, 2 years, 18 months for both. We've set it up since starting on Free North West. There's been many groups that have sort of happened and sprung up from that all over the North West now and beyond. Have you got anybody from Scotland here today? Any Scottish people in? Brave hearts? Nobody here didn't make it, okay? It's even going up there to Newcastle and Scotland where the groups are starting to settle up now. Along with Critical Mass Radio, that sort of coincides with everything there. So there's a 24/7 unit where it's proactive and people can basically listen to all these shows, get things off the chest and know that everything's moving forward in the truth movement. We will not all agree on everything that is said today, but please have the forethought to just accept that everybody's different and we all have different opinions, and just accept it, and that way we get on a lot better, won't we, as a whole truth movement actually. So, what I'm going to do is introduce now Mr. Mark Cockey. Mark, I saw Mark about 5 years ago now on the Edge programme. On Sky, that's gone now. I'm taking that one down. And straight away, this chap with all this knowledge, really way just putting everything forward, captured my imagination and helped me on my awakening. Very in-depth talk that you're going to be listening to today, the impression of the occult says it all. So what I'm going to do is let Mark go straight forward. And please now give a round of applause for Mark Cockey. Thank you.
Technical problems. I've never done a presentation before using this beast here, so I tackled it for the first time ever, but as you might have noticed, I don't have control over them using that because the wire doesn't reach and so on. So these are the things. Everyone's doing the best they can with what they've got. We all know that feeling now. Let's just run with it, and I'll hopefully nod in the right direction, but the truth is I've randomised very much the order of what I'm going to do for a very specific purpose, which might come clear later on if I get it right, and if it doesn't, tough, but we'll run with this, alright? I first put my head up in public, it was about 5 years, was it 5 years? Correctly, 5 years ago, when, almost on a random whim, having come out of financial services and 30 years in, it's called banking, but it was actually as a mortgage specialist. I did mortgages all of my career, basically. Within building societies, quite ironically. Then they all turned to banks. So I then, in studying for what's called the associateship and then the fellowship of the Chartered Institute of Bankers, stumbled across a lot of stuff, a lot of hoity-toity people. We've all come across them that were saying things that just didn't tally with me. And to cut a very long story short, I remember one day in a place called Fallon's Hall, the centre of the Institute of Bankers in Hertfordshire, saying to somebody, I'm not going to drop names tonight, they'll be the odd one for specific purposes, but I'm going to avoid names because it's so irrelevant. I asked him who issued the currency. Because they didn't talk about that. And quite the honest answer was you don't ever ask that and you never talk about it. So, as I explained on this at Edge Media, a couple of appearances I've done on there, that's really what triggered my mind into wondering what was... Well, why... Right, so where was I? The whole banking thing. I cottoned on from an early age, and you can't justify this except retrospectively, I felt different about everything that was going on around me. People were acting like tossers, and I thought, well, actually, am I the tosser, or are they the tossers? What's going on? And it takes time to work that out. And the day I asked the question, well, who issues the currency, and what do they make out of it? You should have seen the reaction. It was like blank. And you don't go there. So, you know, this does tell me that people at a certain level do know that you don't cross that line. If you do, your career's gone. And if you don't, then as long as you toe the line and do well and sell as much as you can sell, then you will get on. Around about the same time as I was studying for the financial stuff, I, very much out of interest in these things, became involved in what you would call the occult. I didn't know what the occult was at the time, other than people told me it meant hidden things. Did it mean Satanism? Did it mean, well, I don't know. So I go and look. If someone says, don't look down there, the first thing you're going to do is look down there. And the first thing you come across with the occult is a lot of people saying, ooh, don't play with the occult. Don't do that. Don't look. The churches tell you this. The religions tell you this. And I wondered why that was. There is an element of truth in it. You don't play with the occult. I recommend everyone looks at it. I really do, because your churches are the masters of the occult. And I'll touch back as I talk over the next hour. We'll take a pee break and a comfort break or whatever at the right moment, hopefully. You will find that the occult and finance are actually one and the same thing, ultimately. It took me a long time to work this out. And then, at a certain point in my career, I decided that rather than do what my colleagues were doing, which was, and this sounds noble, but it's not meant that way, rather than getting their nice posh houses in the country and doing what bankers do, and trust me, they do it, it's unbelievable, I wanted to understand what was going on. I always felt there was something wrong. I'm not telling you anything that probably you haven't all thought. Put your hand up if you haven't felt that there is something seriously wrong with the world. You don't have to, there's a hand going up, thank you. But you don't have to understand what's wrong, you just know there's something wrong. Well, I did this years and years ago, and I would say I was privileged, but it wasn't. It was a complete dishonor to be thrown among some of the worst scum I've ever met in my life. So I tried to keep a moral and straight road, and of course I was a teenager, 20s, 30s, and your moral principles grow with you. So I'm not looking back and saying, hey, I did this then, and I'm cool. No, I made some very naive mistakes, but if I hadn't made them, I wouldn't be able to present this to you today. I wouldn't have the understanding I've got. I don't stand here and say, I know it all. But 30 odd years ago, where am I? Yeah, it must be 30 odd years ago. I joined a Druid organization. And I still use that Druid philosophy to this day. In full realization that that Druid philosophy is what actually underlies every other religion you can possibly name, probably. There are exceptions. But again, that was with research, study, involvement, and hindsight. So, I want to talk about Druidry today, and the principles of the occult, how it relates to finance, also how it relates to this truth movement. So call it what you will, research movement, truth movement, any other names? Can anyone suggest a name? That's no. Well, that kind of sums up what I'm on about.
Freeman.
Freeman, sorry. Freeman, thank you.
Awakened.
All of this, yeah, awakened. That's the word I was expecting to hear.
Conscious.
We all kind of know what we're talking about, but we struggle to put it into words, don't we? Because I do, I certainly. So if I say, hey, I'm awakened and you're only partially awakened, I don't mean that at all. There'll be people in this room who know a lot more about some of what I'm going to talk about than I do. Equally, I know a lot more than some of the people in this room about some of the subjects and so on. Do you see what I mean? This is there for us all to get. I could well end up offending a lot of people. I have done this, actually, and this is why I butted out of this whole truth movement about 3 years back, having put my head up. There's some wonderful people, some absolute tossers too. But, well, as you do, you go, you know. And many of the people in this whole movement I met, and I did this not just 5 years ago, but actually 30 years ago, 20 odd years ago. Because that's where I found myself. It's not like I woke up one day and said, I'm going to do this, and so on. So what I want to do is give you a brief summary, which might not become so brief, of what I did, where I get my perspectives, and then I want to hit you with my perspectives, which will upset some of you, I'm sure. Because to this day, I mean, it's hard to summarize this, I'm sure, and I challenge any of you to do it. We live in a situation where people are awakening,
but they're not sure what to. I think the best description I've ever given is it's like waking up into someone else's nightmare. And in fact, that is what you're doing. If you think you've touched on the nightmare, think again. It goes so much deeper. This is not to scare you. This is to point out what these people know, in my opinion, and I'll try and qualify that as far as I possibly can. Over the time that I've spent doing my researches, I've come across people from ranging from, of course, activists on the street, politicians, bankers, Knights Templar. Dare I mention Knights Templar? Knights Templars are the baddies, aren't they? Eh? There's a whole story there, and people need to get their head around it. I'll touch on many subjects. If the subject doesn't interest you, just bypass it and follow the one that does. But I'm going to put a kind of counterpoint to much that has been said about all of this and who's running the world and why they're doing it. And then I'll kind of leave it at that and see where it settles. We have another talk afterwards on occult principles. I won't agree, he won't agree. I bet there'll be a 95% overlap on everything that's said. But I want to show people here tonight where I went. Not believe me, not do this. Actually, I'm going to show you the ultimate secret that the Illuminati themselves know, and I will challenge you to point anything out that's wrong about it. Not that I'll take you into great detail, you'll have to go and look for yourself. But I have, and this is my point, I've spent 25 years speaking to scientists from all branches, theologians from all branches, politicians from all branches, people like ourselves from all branches, showing them what I discovered a while back and what I think it means. And not one, and we're talking some senior scientists here, heads of universities and so on, who have ever come back and said, that's wrong because. So I challenge you, and this challenge is ongoing. The reason I came across this was I realized that this Illuminati, as everyone's calling them nowadays, are running the world. Is it the Illuminati? The first thing I found when I researched the Illuminati is that they were actually shut down very much so by the Jesuits. That's a matter of recorded history. Doesn't mean they didn't continue. But I'll now tell you a few stories, and let's just see where this goes. Let me be clear. Someone does run this world. They run it even better and even more controlled than you, as researchers into this, might even imagine. Some of you, I'm sure, will have touched on some of this. So I want to take you right over the top into where they're going, what they were looking for, when they found it, and I'll leave you to decide what it means to you. As to the occult, what it means, or the conspiracy, or who's behind it, as I said 5 years ago, if you really want to pin down who's behind it, then that's your life done. All right, you will take your life doing that. Because probably by now, talking 5 years ago, they've changed anyway. One of them has, to my knowledge. So that's my point. This is an ongoing thing. It's not about names, it's about principles. This is my keying the next thing. So here's a... And do forgive me if these are crap, because I did these myself and I've never done this. But anyway, here's a little picture that Kate's son drew out for me. I liked it because there they are. They've invented an all-seeing eye poker, and they're poking the all-seeing eye. My point in displaying this is that rather than just poking them in the eye, I've thought for 20 years now that we can actually give them a right kick in the balls, not just poke them in the eye. I've mentioned a Pythagorean kick. Has anyone come across the Pythagorean kick or Pythagorean comma? Hand up? No? Right. We'll be touching on that later, and that's very key to what I'm saying, but I don't mention it much, hopefully, in what I'm going to say. To acquire knowledge, one must study, and to acquire wisdom, one must observe. Is there anything wrong with that comment? Because I've noticed in the truth movement, people do not observe, they study. And study means read and believe 80% of the time. Okay? This isn't putting any individuals down, just a general concept. Can I have the next one? Oh, that graphic was by... Oh, it doesn't matter. Here's the next one by a friend of mine. I asked her just to draw a graphic which illustrates the people putting the capstone of wisdom back on this eternal pyramid of theirs. Something which nearly happened in the year 2000, but was stopped on the Giza plateau because of the symbology of putting the capstone on the pyramid. We'll get into this occult esoteric stuff as we progress. So the questions I ask, and I'm not here to tell you what I think or what you should think. It's really to ask you questions, because I've got more questions about you than you probably have about me, even assuming you saw me a few years ago on this TV thing. You've all come across the Eye of Horus. Now, a lot of what I'm talking about is about seeing. You have to use your own perceptions in this. We'll touch much later on in detail here. What do you see there? Is there anything about this that does not match that? And therefore you have to stop and actually ponder what it is that this symbol means. Has anyone heard of the Watchers from history? The Biblical Watchers? If you were a Biblical Watcher in reality, what sign do you think you would use to tell people you're watching over them? Ponder. This is the secret behind Freemasonry. It's how the brain actually works, and it's all to do with the pineal gland and so on. Again, most Freemasons wouldn't even begin to get that, and those who have passed through those degrees would agree with what I just said. But I just wanted to show those pictures side by side, because that really is what the all-seeing eye itself was based upon originally. It also had fractions on it. These were a half, a quarter, a third, an eighth, a sixteenth. These were detailed on that original picture. I couldn't actually get them on here. So they were showing geometries. Reciprocal geometry was part of this Eye of Horus originally. This can be proven. I can't prove it to you now, but if you go and look, you'll see it straight away. Next slide, please. So the question that I'm asking out of all of this is that, and you see, I can't even print it properly on the screen, but I think we need to ask a question. We really need to ask a question of ourselves and of those who we claim to be oppressing us. But how can we ask a question when we've already got so many answers? We've got the Freeman answer, the legal arguments. We've got the occult, we've got the financial. It's all confusing. It's too confusing. But I believe we need to ask these gatekeepers, these people who, and we know they're there, we so know that they're there and who they are, in real political terms, real people, we need to go and ask a question in full public view. I said this years ago, I still stand by it, having been ridiculed and put down for being naive. The beauty of this is it's naive, it's simple, and I'll show you the ultimate secret of creation almost. It's so simple, but I can't actually then take you beyond that point. You have to do it for yourself, so I will only touch upon it today. So the point is, what do we ask the gatekeepers? Because anyone seen, I'm going to forget the name, I'm terrible with names, the David Bowie film, which I should know straight away, Labyrinth. Has anyone seen Labyrinth? Yeah. And they come across two guards guarding gateways. One gateway goes to death, for want of a better word. The other one goes to life. Good, bad, whatever you want to call it. There's a gatekeeper in front of each gate, and you come up to these gates, and you want to go through the gate to life, don't you? You don't want to go through the gate or door to death. But each one has a gatekeeper. And one will lie to you every time. They can't do anything else. The other will always tell the truth. Do you get that? What one question can you ask of one of those people that will tell you which door to go through? We'll come back to that. Does anyone know the answer to that, by the way? Don't shout it out, but this is the concept that I'm dealing with here. I'll refer to it as a mirror, a space mirror. and many other things as we go on. But please keep that concept in mind, because there is a question you can ask which will tell you definitively what door to go through. Okay? And we'll even take that a concept further. As someone pointed out, you don't even need two gatekeepers. You can have one. We will come back to that. So, I'm trying to draw this picture of the gatekeepers who can either let us through to a successful future, or who can either destroy everything that we, the future entirely. We need to ask them a question in full public view. So, just moving on from that one. The Nag Hammadi text. This is where the random stuff comes in a little bit, okay? Anyone come across or read the Nag Hammadi Gospels in one? Yeah.
Greg Braden, he's done quite a lot of them.
Greg Braden. Yeah, brilliant. Then the Nag Hammadi Gospels, basically, this really kind of messed the church up, because they spent centuries falsifying documents to convince people of story A, and then story B comes out in history in original form. So they had to really try and crush this, but they obviously you can't. These are historic documents. There's some of the sayings. Obviously, I could go through 150, 200 different sayings, but I'm bringing this in now to point out, hopefully, something to you. So first of all, it starts, the very opening line of the Gospel of Thomas is, these are the secret sayings that the living Jesus spoke and Didymus, Judas, Thomas recorded. Didymus, Judas, Thomas, all mean the twin. All three words mean twin. Would you disagree on that? That would be good. So Jesus said, and I'll come back to Jesus later on, I'm not a Christian, as I pointed out, but I have researched who Jesus was, and I do find that at the top it's quite well known who he was and what the true story was, so I'll relate that to you. And he says, whoever discovers the interpretation of these sayings will not taste death. Those who seek should not stop seeking until they find. When they find, they will be disturbed, and when they're disturbed, they will marvel, and they will reign over all. And after they've reigned, they will rest. The one who seeks will find. The one who knocks, to that it will be open. There's a message coming over here. This guy, whoever, and this stuff's still here thousands of years later, because of Ken, if you wrote this down now, no one would give a shit tomorrow morning. Do you know what I mean? But here we are thousands of years later, and people are still pondering over this. There's a reason for this. There really is. You might say, I'm not a Christian, I'm not religious, I'm not this, I'm not that, I'm not the other. Well, that's fine, but you are. You live in a world that's ruled by these people, whether you care to acknowledge it or not. If you have money, do not lend it out at interest. That's pretty damn clear, isn't it? Pretty clear. This is one of the first things that got me in finance and banking. Rather, give it to the one from whom you will not get it back. Yeah. Who's done that? We have 5, 6, 7. Oh, now there's more, right? Everyone's done it, actually. Come on, we all have. And this is the point. This really is the point. But if you go into Lloyd's Bank tomorrow and say, hey, the dude says, you got to give me that money without interest, and you're not going to get it back, what are they going to say to you? Jesus also said, show me the stone that the builders have rejected. It is the cornerstone. Now, you've heard this. Anyone who's done occult research comes across this frequently with the Masons. That's a cornerstone for them. They don't understand what it means, but it becomes apparent if they actually put the work in. So, money, I've introduced here, the whole concept of that. I'd like to put... got through a few papers here. This is where not having a computer kind of makes it slightly awkward, so I'll skim through this, but we'll come back on it later if there's any questions. I have here a document, it's, I don't know, 20 odd pages, printed out, it's called Genesis chapter 1 verse 1. That's an analysis by the Priory of Zion, if anyone's come across them, on Genesis chapter 1. At the top of the page, there's three translations, one in Gaelic, one in English, and one in Egyptian, of the opening lines of this gospel. This comes straight out of the Vatican Library, by the way. In the beginning, the Grand Vicar built a model of heavens on earth. And that's heavens, not heaven. The other one is, I give you speak, the beginning of the temple is the key. That's the Egyptian, and hence the lack of English sense in that statement. So anyway, each of these ancient translations indicate the true meaning of the first words of the King James Bible. King James, in 1698, commissioned the Reverend George Buchanan, principal of the University of Alloa, moderator of the Church of Scotland, to translate the Latin and Greek versions into English to enable all citizens to understand the true history of the ancient world. The Reverend Dr. John Dury, there's a whole list of names here which are pretty irrelevant, and the Grand Prior Robert Flood assisted the authors in various chapters. The Temple Bible was submitted to Hampton Court Convention in 1707, together with the recommendations from the Church of England and the Roman Catholic Church. Changes were agreed and the authorised Bible was published. To prevent certain knowledge becoming available to the canons of the Roman Catholic Church, the Templars apparently translated words in such manner as to retain the secrets of the ancient Cathar and Chaldee Bibles. Words were missed out from the original Gaelic or Chaldee Bible, while other words were substituted from the Syrian Bible. I could go on there, if this didn't keep feeding back on me. Buchanan, recalling the problem of the Inquisition in Portugal, must have been aware of the dangers in his life and that of his young student, the future King of Scotland and England. Many parts of the old biblical story therefore had to be changed or further doctored in case of causing trouble with the Church of Rome. It's only today that the research into the older versions of the Bibles from around the world, that the science of theology is beginning to find out the real truth. Words such as oile, meaning knowledge or science, were translated as holy. Entire passages were missed out to prevent the uninitiated from understanding the true meaning. Chapters such as Genesis 5 were transformed into an impossible sequence of years. The descendants of Adam and Noah lived. We all seen this in the Bible, across it, Noah lived 800 years or whatever it was. It's like, duh, how did they do that? There actually is a way they could have done it, but that's not the point. By translating only two words, generations into numbers and Adam into Item, the temple of time, we have a clue to understanding the true meaning of religion. The word re in Gaelic refers to the moon, lich are also the words for Leo, the constellation of the lion. Ich translates as science or knowledge, and on as the temple of on, at Sais in Heliopolis, or Cairo, as mentioned in the Bible, the science or knowledge of the heaven, moon, and stars. Holy means the science or knowledge of the heavens, moons, and stars. A Russian-German Bible found by the German Knights Templar at Heidelberg University gives a full description of where the first temple was erected in antiquity. That temple is still extant, and it shows how the ancient astro-surveyors, or Alak, I can't pronounce this, you know, I'm not into Gaelic, so I won't even bother. They were men of skill in many fields of science, especially in astronomy, mathematics, surveying, law, and medicine. There are also extant letters of the Alad of pre-Roman Scotland, written by Julius Caesar, Strabo, Cicero, Pliny, it goes on, there's a whole list. People say that these things were not recorded in history. They damn well were. It's just your church didn't let you have access to them. So I will kind of skip through this because there's a very key point here. And that is, I made a note here about the Rosetta Stone. There appeared to be a fourth translation in the Rosetta Stone. This was a mathematical one. It became obvious that the paintings of the pharaohs held the key to understanding measures used in the building of the pyramids. All pharaohs and figures of gods and animals appear to be holding surveyors' staffs in their hands, and they do. Those surveying staffs seem to be of two sizes. Moses was renowned as having a rod and a staff.
Therefore, measuring the sacred scepter confirmed the length of this staff. Blah, blah, blah. They're going on into where they get the measurements from in the Bible. Research into relics saved from the Inquisition's greedy grasp and lust for gold was the Troano Codex. This 70-page book is part of something that's now called the Madrid Codex. And it's the largest of several Aztec and Mayan manuscripts to survive the bonfires. This is where your 2012 prophecies came from. Did you all pick up on this? How the world was going to end in 2012. At no point in those codices did it say that. None at all. I know because I read them. I've read many books by people who hadn't as well. It's amazing. This book tells of the men who sailed from another land and who educated the Native Americans in civil administration, astronomy, agriculture, building, maths, etc. As well, the mathematics found in these pages, as well as in their temples, illustrates common knowledge between Egypt and other lands, the use of the sacred scepters of Caledonia. Can I emphasize that point now? Because I am skipping. This point would have been made better with it on screen. But we're talking about Caledonia. The Priory of Zion. Some of you think that's a bad organization. Some of you think it's a good organization. Some of you won't even have heard of it. It's all a front anyway. It doesn't matter who the people are. This is the research that they've been doing. And people keep going on about secret societies. How they run the world. How they're bad. How they're doing this. How they're doing that. If it weren't for the secret societies, you'd have none of this information. None at all. The churches would have killed it thousands of years ago. That's the truth. So, you have secret societies out there of ordinary people like you and you and you, and you're researching things that interest you. That's not to deny that at the top they don't know the answers. They've got people researching this and they're looking for something that they know was missing. You've heard of the missing word of masonry, for example. Something was missing. And the reason it's missing is because it was known once before and everything was forgotten and destroyed in massive global earth changes, as might become apparent later on. This can't be denied now. It's proven. Scientifically proven, historically proven. The only people who deny it are those whose careers depend upon denying it. So, the emergence of a scale of octaves appeared to be similar to the tonal and chromatic scales of Johann Kepler. This is in ancient Chinese manuscripts used by Confucius and his mathematical sieves. A document from Korea was also translated to indicate the formula used in ancient Scotland can be found in Genesis chapter 5. Right, I've skipped a bit to bring you to the point. In Genesis chapter 5, it tells you the ages of Adam, Seth, Canaan, Jared, blah, blah, blah. The entire family at that time, or history of that time. However, if you know what to do with those numbers, they translate into, I have a grid there, which even if I put it on screen, it would mean nothing to you other than they are datum levels, all right? So where this takes you, and I'm talking to you about this because when I first studied these things years ago, this was the one I particularly fell into, and I'll tell you where it took me. Does anyone live near Blackburn, by the way? Fascinating story on this one.
Defended against bailiffs there.
Sorry?
We've
sent bailiffs. You're a good one. That's it. I'm in Blackburn. I'll come back, because it's not that far from here, is it?
No.
It's
in Manchester.
Have you seen the A666 goes through Blackburn? Yeah, right.
Bolton.
Yeah.
Which way?
All right, that's where I mean. All right, down there. Have you ever seen where the other end of it is?
Pendle, is it?
Pendle.
Get in. Right. Well, I've been through it. I spent a great 2 days actually in Pendle. Strange place. Real people like you and me living in this wonderful place, who are really affected by something that happened centuries ago. It's there. It's tangible. Okay, you get your witches' tea rooms and all this kind of thing. They love that. But the people themselves, tangibly affected, psychologically disturbed by the massacres that took place in that village Go talk to them. It's amazing. Ordinary people like you and you, because you like to play around with herbs and so on, were slaughtered and burned alive. Amazing. Pendle witches. Great story. Ties into this one. A666. Who would build a bloody road and call it the A666? And where do you think it goes? Where would it go? The land of the Ark. Lancashire. And if you go to Blackburn, up near the Scottish borders, in Lanarkshire, the land of the Ark in Gaelic, you start to suss that actually these people were trying to design this country and actually succeeded in doing it around something that they understood and you don't. But honestly, this is where I stumbled into an awful lot, and it literally was something as simple as pursuing that A666 route, which goes right past, I believe, a mental hospital. But it does that. This route, not the A666 itself, but the route that was intended, goes up to Blackburn in Lanarkshire in Scotland. If you draw that line between the two, it's great. Because what's the first thing you do when you draw a line? You cut it in half, don't you? Is it what's in the middle? Do it. Right, anyway. This then goes on to discuss the pyramids and so on. I think I will very much skip through this. The three stones of destiny. Anyone know about the stone of Scone? Yeah. The Scottish stone on which the queen is crowned and so on. I was going to tell you the story of that.
Is it supposed to be fake, though?
Oh, the one they're sitting on now is fake, yeah. But if you want the original, it's quite...
Was in the chapel, wasn't it?
It was
in the chapel once.
Yeah. As I said, I could read this page and it would confirm what you're saying there. But I really want to move on, because the point I'm making here is, and let's get this, it doesn't matter whether you agree with the detail in here. Oh, and the detail, incidentally, gives these grid references and datum points, which puts the first temple of Jerusalem in Alloa in Scotland.
Oh, is Edinburgh?
Alloa. Okay? Oh, well, Edinburgh, you've got Arthur's Seat.
Yeah.
It's very much tied in. Of course, it is very much, and again, I could detail it, but it's a home field of research. Now, the point I'm making is, don't believe what I'm telling you, but the people in the secret societies who have informed those above don't only believe this, but know it. It's proven. This stuff is provable. So if you go back into ancient history, what you actually then have is that the first temple was built in Scotland, and they claim, I don't know if I can find it here, they know about Atlantis. Here's the Queen's relation to the ancient history, and the night through the Knights Templar and so on. They know about an island or some disaster that happened a long, long time ago. Masons research it, Templars have researched it, every secret society on the face of the planet has researched it, and long ago they came up with, well, it was self-evident that there was a real disaster on this planet that trashed everything that went before. So, if we had civilization on this planet that went before, it either didn't get as far as we have now, or it did. If it did, it would be leaving signs of that. Look around you, pyramids, yeah, come on. People tell you, pyramidiot. I'm a pyramidiot, apparently. Yes, it's better than being a complete twat, don't you think? But the point is, it's there. Geometry, numbers, it puts everybody off because you were trained to do it. But guess what? The most complex understanding of everything that the Illuminati have ever claimed to know could be sussed by a six-year-old. That's maybe a 12-year-old. I'm exaggerating. And I'll touch on some of that with you tonight. And when you don't get it, please don't feel stupid. Yeah? Because I'm not going into this in the detail that I really would do. It's not a presentation about that. I always ask myself, this is the enemy. They issue our currency and enslave everybody in doing that. But what do they know that enabled them to do that? They control the military, they control everything to a degree that I never even believed 20 years ago, but it even goes beyond what I imagined. How do they do that? What is it they know? Well, one thing they know, because they've got every damn secret society around the world for centuries researching it, is what happened back then and what happened to the technology that was used back then. Now, if you can't accept an ancient civilization that was destroyed on this planet, then you'll have a problem with anything else that follows. But the point I've made, and I've spoken to researchers, academics, all sorts of people about this over decades, there's no one seriously questions this. The only people who question this are the people on the damn street who think, ha, you can't, don't be silly. Atlantis, isn't that a theory? Wake up. I don't call it Atlantis, by the way, but that's beside the point. This happened. This is the point of this research. So, they pinned down the first temple to Jerusalem. With datum lines and so much more evidence, it'd be quite frightening to go through it for you. But that's one document. That's one secret society. There are, like, many more. So, I determined I wasn't going to listen to them. I have studied the Rosicrucian study documents, the entire course of learning, they would call it, the Druid course of learning. I've done this stuff. I have never, ever joined an organization, because the moment I do is when I'll get tied down into that. I realized ages ago, if I was going to survive this, and I had cause to realize it was a survival game years ago, I need to keep my head down and just learn and take it from there. So that's what I did. Call it spineless. I had very good reason to be quite spineless. And it's all very simple. Who are these people? Who the hell are they? And what is it about the occult that we do not understand? So anyone seen this picture before? Other than the ones I've shown it to. Now, I caused a right stir across the global internet a few weeks ago when I posted a picture, which I'll show you next. This is Winston Churchill, incidentally. This is not doubted, by the way. There's Churchill there. That is Winston Churchill. This is just my technology and the quality of the photograph. That's not denied. That was Winston Churchill's... in fact, the Druid Orders to this day post that and are quite proud of it. Initiated into the Druid Order in 1906, I think it was. So, who do you think came along with him? In fact, she didn't come along with him, but... enter Princess. Elizabeth. Pick? There, yeah. There she is. That was our Queen's initiation into the Druid Order in 1947, I think it was. I'd have to check the records. There she is. And people have said to me, well, anyone could Photoshop. It's like, yeah, sure. These are known people in the Druid Order, these people around her. There you go. Does that make them bad? Does that make them bad? You have Prince Charles, who wants to be, what is it he called it? Defender of the faiths. Yeah? Well, when I joined the Druid Order, and this was back in, I forget dates, it was bloody decades ago, and the dates get confusing. The point is, I joined this order, they're very proud of who it is. The first thing that I was doing within weeks of getting involved was actually going around Christian churches, actually Durham Cathedral, and teaching, supposedly, here's me, I'd never done philosophy or any of this, but we were going into Christian churches and teaching them how to reintroduce spirituality into their services, because they kind of lost it, you know what I mean, if you hadn't noticed. So, that was profound. And you speak to the head of the order, Philip Cargon, to this day, he's just released a great book on English Druidry, and in it he lauds Prince Charles. He's brilliant. Prince Charles is probably the most spiritual person that ever walked on England's green and pleasant pastures. And oh my God. He's lording it up. And this is why I fell out with him. I didn't fall out, I just left.
many years ago, because I think it was, I did my research, it was the Reckon Trust. It was set up by Trevelyan, Sir George Trevelyan, to re-establish the Druid orders, to reintroduce not the occult, but the more esoteric understandings, because they're trying to create a new world religion. Does that condemn Druidry? No, it doesn't. But when it's in the hands of people like this, God help us, truly, as you're knowing. Now, how many, and I ask this, how many Church of England priests or whatever could stand here and look at that picture and justify it? What would they say? What do you think they would say? Well, they're not allowed to swear, so I can assure you that if you ask a bishop what he makes of that picture, not a lot. The whole damn thing is like this, and I whittled about on this edge meter a few years ago. It's the Mobius strip. Many of you will have come across this, I'm sure, but it's a simple concept. It's just one side. You take a piece of card, a strip of card, and you put one twist in it and join the ends together. If you then trace around, you'll find, I can't do it here in 2D, but you'll find there's only one side to this geometric form. How can that be? Ponder that one. And ponder also the question we started with. How do you ask the gatekeeper the way through? All right, I'm talking about mirrors and geometry and the occult knowledge here, and I'm being evasive deliberately because you have to work for this yourselves. But quite honestly, I do know 12 and 15 year olds who have got this. This is not difficult stuff, and I don't mean based on this presentation. I might just be destroying you with my little presentation, but there you go. Next one. So here's something that fascinated me. Here we have a guy called David Icke, who I helped into this country, organised his first couple of meetings with others. Here's the letters. You know, I got accused of lying about this, but there's the letters here from David Icke asking me if I can do these things. You haven't seen them, but they're here for anyone who wants to. Like I was claiming glory on the back of this. No, I pointed out that David Icke, I was very interested in what he was doing and did anything I could do to support him. Which meant getting on the ground, going out, delivering leaflets, getting people involved, groundwork. That's actually what I do. As my colleagues will probably profess soon. So, there we go. I got involved with David Icke. I've probably personally spent 6-7 hours alone with him. The only issue he ever had with me, you've got to check the airflow again, apparently. The only issue we ever had was I pointed out I was Druid, and he said, oh, it's just another of those religions. I said, no, David, you're the new religion. I'm the old one, and it's not a religion. And it's not a religion. I have no religion. This is about common sense and the use of the mind. That's all it's about. I've watched David Icke create a new religion and blow thing out of the water with his reptiles. Now, I know that if you trace back through history, you'll find reptiles left, right and centre. But you can find out what they mean as well. You can find out what they were written about and so on. And I would go so far as to say, when it comes to reptiles, it may be true, but let me tell you this, they do not run this world, alright? If there's any alien races out there, they're irrelevant to who's doing this to us now. I'll just go into a few more of my little experiences then, because having left school and going straight into banking and coming across this sort of problem about who issues the currency and making realizations, I then pursued that. I studied, I got the fellowship of the Chartered Institute of Bankers, the associateship of the Chartered Building Societies Institute, all exams which the day you get mean nothing. It's like, so what, you know? You've just got to repeat their information to get them. So I started my own research way back then. I used to sit in libraries as a kid. I disappeared. Where have you been? I've been sat in the library reading books. on what? Well, it could be anything that interested me at the time. But I was convinced there was something seriously up and I was going to get to the bottom of it. And it was to do with money and the people who issue it. Anyway, I then set up, and this was actually, I have a letter in there suggesting it, that I set this organisation up with colleagues called the Earth Foundation. And the idea was we would gather information from whatever source, and think, well, that is useful over there, so we'll give that information to you, and we'll give this to you, and so on. And that's what we did. You can see how that was kind of superseded by the internet rather rapidly. But the principle was there, and for a couple of years I was getting information sent to me from all angles, some of which I pursued, the 666 and Blackburn being one of them, because I had people living on it, and we pursued that. It was actually pursuing that that introduced me to the Knights Templar, incidentally. The very real people who do exist in this country.
There's 66 up to Burnley as well.
All right. So anyway, one of the things I came across, no names, no sources, but it was something that dropped out of somebody's nose one day, which somebody suggested might be an alien implant, yeah? So there we go. So we actually contacted NASA, Northwest Laboratories, and sent that off to them. And then we got a report back on what it is. And the long and the short is it was a capacitor, all right? A slightly better capacitor than was currently being used at the time. That really intrigued me. It's like, because I know that came out of someone's nose, right? And you've got these scientists saying, it's a snot. It's not, they didn't say that at all. It's a capacitor with full analysis on it. Anyway, so there's all this interesting stuff coming in. It's like something is going on. So I'm writing to the heads of physics departments in universities. Here's one on the half-life of the proton, and so on and so forth. Graham Hancock, George Trevelyan. He's noted to be the father of the New Age movement. For 2 years, I was communicating with Sir George Trevelyan for a very good reason. I was told I might want to contact him by somebody else, so I did that quite randomly. We've all had it, you follow these little paths, don't you? So I did. And there I was, talking to George Trevelyan, and this is the guy who set up the Reckon Trust, which established the Druids in the recent decades, and so on. I was very, very concerned, because he's the best friend of Prince Charles. So one day, after about 2 years, I asked him a question about Prince Charles, and I never, ever got to speak to the man again. What was the question? We might get to it later on, because it's all about asking a question. Sorry, there's things here that I was doing for the Earth Foundation, which is analysis of scientific papers that were being submitted, just so we could, not that I'm a qualified scientist, but from those I've met, I don't think that means very much nowadays. Anyway, so remember that earlier they were measuring stuff. It was all about measurements, pyramid measurements and so on. Here's another paper. This is signed by A.M. Davy, very famous within research circles. The yard, the pendulum and the meter. And my son said to me, well, what's so bloody interesting about measurements? The point is, measurements unlock history. They prove what was built in previous millennia. And the techniques that we use to
I'll read it out.
Sorry for bending over the paper. When Professor Tom set out to prove that men in ancient times used a unit of measure which he proposed was 2.732 feet, this became known as the megalithic yard. All right, so I'm just going to write that number down up here. Somebody wrote moist on here. I thought it was a really cool word to start the whole thing with. I could have thought of so many worse things than that. So we'll run with that. And here's the definition of moisture. 2.732. I'll just put that there for now. That was the megalithic yard.
It's 2 point.
2 point. There you go. I put that information out there a few years ago. David Icke still hasn't damn well picked up on it because he's convinced that the moon is a space alien base and they got it.
Anyway, don't get me wrong, I'm not ridiculing. Without him, we would be so much further back. But to me, he's missed the point. And in trying to point it out to him, he gets very, very, very defensive, as do most of these damn people. Which is why, incidentally, I've not done this. I'm not out there touring around talking. I was offered... Ooh, I'm angry now. I was offered a few years ago to go out on the talk circuit around the world and get paid. I think that's really cool because my career's knackered. Let's do that. No, no. It's not. It's about being on the street. It's literally, this is a war, as far as I'm concerned, that we are engaged in. A real war. And one day, God forbid, it's going to come to real war too, God forbid, unless we stop it before then. And that's my point. I've developed a couple of philosophies on this. I had an argument a couple of years ago with someone who was saying, apparently I was, what's the in phrase? Low empathy. Anyone heard low empathy? That's a nice meme that's been injected over the last couple of years. I was low empathy because I thought that his opinion, well, actually, I didn't think, I sprayed my beer. I was having a couple of pints. All right, I'd have three, to be honest. And what he said amused me, so I laughed. I was being accused of disrespecting his opinion. Let me make this clear. You can take this as arrogance. You take it whatever way you want. It's not arrogance. It's actually annoyance. I respect your opinions, all of them. Every last one of them, you have a right to hold them. But if it truly is hilarious, I reserve the right to laugh at it. Is that not fair? And you can do the same for me, yeah? If I point something out that's just truly stupid, laugh at me. But because you know what people do, because what I say to them tends to be truly stupid. Point is, I'm not the truly stupid one. And we're all working on this at street level. We're finding these people. You point out there's a conspiracy of finance or whatever. Oh no, you're a paranoid, schizophrenic, whatever else words they can nobble together out of usually a very limited vocabulary to say that you're a conspiracy theorist. Right. Well, I've battled these people for years. My advice, let them get on with it. Don't try and convince anyone. So here he is, trying to convince people today that he's right, yeah? Solipsism. Let's just go through this. This is, and think of David Icke and many other characters in this, me too. The only thing that one has direct access to is the content of one's own mind. And just because one sees an object does not mean that that object exists. You could be dreaming or hallucinating. The whole argument, basically, without going through all of that, is that your mental states are the only thing you have access to. Everything you've ever experienced goes through there. So you have to stop and think about that.
What's real?
Solipsism says that you don't exist. You just don't exist. You're a figment of my imagination. It's all an illusion. Everything is an illusion. That's solipsism. This is what David Icke puts out there.
Yeah.
Now that's great. If you've got any degree of intellect, you can work this through for yourself. Now, forgive me, but I don't look out there and see much intellect on the streets in public level, quite honestly. This is the issue nowadays. So, what do they get? What do the people who hear that get? It's all an illusion. It doesn't matter anyway. It's all an illusion. There's nothing we can do. Well, bollocks to that. It's rubbish. And this, I suspect, and David could come back and defend on this one, but this is the problem that, to me, Icke has created. He's created a whole generation of people who believe that reptiles run the world and that it's all an illusion anyway. So, on the next slide...
It's not what he's saying.
I know what he's saying. No, I'm summarising. I'm summarising the best way I can. Solipsism. And he certainly does say, did he not title a book? Did he not put as the title of his book, everything else is illusion? Yeah?
So, it's at that level I'm talking about. I've talked with David for hours about this, so I'm not putting him down. I'm just saying that a lot of people who follow him have got the wrong end of the stick. And that's because he doesn't understand something, which is actually quite humanly possible. I defended David from day one on this, and I'm not attacking him now. But I think those who are listening to what he's saying need to wake up to something that David clearly either doesn't know or doesn't want to know. He's been given the information. Can't run with it. So, next slide. Oh no, that was it, sorry, in favour of solipsism. My mental states are the only thing I have access to. If we could take it to the next slide, the whole point of solipsism is a solipsist who refuses to acknowledge the literal existence of other beings might be forgiven for believing that she was only talking to herself. If to me, you are a figment of my imagination, why am I even bothering to tell you anything? What am I trying to convince you of? This is kind of the problem. Now, the whole point of solipsism goes right into quantum physics, which is provable nonsense, but beyond that, into the same concepts, into what are we? Are we like a holographic projection? And if so, is this all illusion? And so on. That's great. But the people who, to me, in the past who have tackled these concepts have done it in circles whereby they can actually discuss it and not become paranoid nor schizophrenic about this. And I've seen many, many examples of that. And I have. Next slide, please. So, Alan Watts, great philosopher, speaker. He points out that true Zen is not the solemn, sexless ascetic of the liberation of the mind from traditional thought forms to raise human consciousness, which is reality. What I'm putting over here is that there is a subjective reality. If you haven't noticed, it slaps you in the chops every day. So who are we to go around saying, yeah, it's all an illusion, don't worry about it. Let's take it a bit further. This comes as a challenge to the concept of David Icke, but it actually supports him, all right, ultimately. But he needs to change his tack on one or two things, and there's one or two other speakers out there that I think have picked up on the wrong stuff. I can only comment on this, incidentally, from my direct experience. I'm no great philosopher, doesn't mean because I think it's right, it's right. But if it happened to me and I can rationally prove to myself that that's what happened, I have to take that on board. And some of the stuff I've been involved in, whilst listening to people who were explaining how the banking system works, who have never worked within it and got everything they know out of the appendices of a book, I feel the time comes when I need to stand up. Again, about Icke, there's not a thing I read in any of his books, any of them that I hadn't read before. I was reading about, let's not go into it, but there were many books back in the 70s, in the 60s. Everything which was detailed subsequently in David Icke's books, except the updated details as to who owns which companies and so on. All there, not even open to debate. So this was not a great newcoming, as I pointed out to him at the time. And if you haven't got it, my suspicion is that David Icke, great though he is, I wouldn't change a thing, has been used. And when people point it out to him, he's too far gone to actually realise what he's bringing about. But we'll see if we can get there. This is not about David Icke, it's about you. So, reality. It's not that everything isn't real, it's that it is real, right? It is real, and you need to face it, and you need to face it in a real kind of way. And it doesn't mean sticking your face in a book, learning about Freeman concepts, and then going out and getting locked up for saying the wrong thing to a policeman, for example. If you can go out and say those things to a policeman and not get locked up, that's when I'll bloody listen, because I think this Freeman thing is great, and it needs pushing all the damn way. But that's just my humble opinion. Next one, please. I realised at a fairly young age that actually all these snobs and knobs who run the world actually went to a different school than I did, and they learned something different to what I was being taught. So, this is the seven liberal arts.
Could you put your hand up if you know what these are generally? Just give me some kind. Yeah, lovely. The seven liberal arts are what you have to study if you don't want to be a numpty in 2013, basically. Scrap everything you were ever told, go back and do what the elite did, because they learned this. Some of them were such knobs that they didn't take it on board. But this is what you've got to learn. And this is the next slide that this is a realization I made. I should say grammar, rhetoric, geometry, arithmetic, astronomy, music, and dialectica. There's a good one, come back to that. Divides into two, the trivium, grammar, rhetoric, and logic. I can see my friend over here has done this. You're with me, yes?
I've been talking about it before today.
Okay, right. Grammar, rhetoric, and logic. Now, out of the seven, you've got three, so that leaves four, which brings us to the next slide, which is the quadrivium. There. This is what people, in my experience, never quite sussed about the quadrivium. You've got to study maths, geometry, music, and astronomy, or astrology as it was at the time. Wow, what are they? Well, actually, they're all numbers. There's not a thing there that isn't the study of numbers. You've got numbers, numbers in space, numbers in time, and numbers in time and space. Right. Why should numbers be of any relevance at all? Here's the trivium, here's the quadrivium, and here's the senses. This is how they back then defined it, by the way. They put it in a triangle. That's how we see things. We're working a real geometry of learning here, where if you study those three subjects and then those four subjects in a set order, using your five senses, which can be proven in eight ways, we'll come to that, then you'll know everything that there is to be known, or at least what is there to be known, you'll have a mind to know. So bear in mind, I've just pointed out that the four subjects are actually all numbers in different forms of space and time, all right? Which is not taught when you're doing the quadrivium. Next one, please. How do you prove reality? Proof of perception by direct conviction. These can get confusing. I'm going to shut up and let you read this for 30 seconds.
Ways of proving anything. You notice the eighth one is actually transcendental. It's proof of knowledge by non-existence. I mean,
what the heck does that mean? It means something. But the first seven are all here in reality, something you can do and indeed should do. So if someone comes to you and says, Nibiru's out there, it's coming, and the Nephilim are going to come down and we're all damned and so on, hey, history shows that could be a reality. Run it past this, you'll get your answer. Okay? So, and this has been known incidentally for thousands of years, so why the hell they don't teach it in our schools nowadays is open to serious question. If you do this, you don't need to worry about, again, to quote David, what he thinks the moon is. You can prove what the moon is. I proved it to him 10 years ago. And he's not too far wrong, but he ain't right either. In my humble opinion. The problem is, people up there don't have humble opinions anymore, they just run with what they've got, and this is an issue. I've been saying for years, I said it back then, I'll say it now, and it's only thanks to Ken and one or two others here that I'm even bothering to say it again. We need to actually come together on this. It's a point we'll make later. To which the stock response for 5 years has been, oh no, we can't do that, people, we'll give them something to attack. We can't get organized because then the enemy can attack us. We'll get to that. It's annoying to me. It really is annoying when people, supposedly intellectual people, are saying we shouldn't actually do anything because. Right. Well, I learned what to listen to and what not to listen to years ago.
This you listen to. If you run any concept, if you're not sure of anything, and you do this for yourself, you will know what is fact and what is absolute lie. And if it's absolute lie, stand up and call it absolute lie in its face. If we can move on, please. So, this might be a good point for a wee break after this. That's a Scottish thing, wee, small break. We live in a time of... Oh, see, it's going to do that. I can't even read it now. Well, basically, what that says is... Don't get mad at me. Yeah. No, the point of this slide is this. Yeah, we all know there's an awakening going. These are words, yeah, just words. There's an awakening going on. People are realizing stuff. They're moving on. They're waking up. We've all used it. What does that mean? Do you realize that in doing this, you are abiding by the very core, central element of the very mystery schools and the very secret societies, and dare I say, Illuminati. What's the other word that they like to use?
Elite. What?
Them. It's actually, I'm thinking more of Venus and Luciferian. Luciferian. That's one that needs defining. But the point being, you, in waking up, are doing exactly what the Luciferians have told you you need to be doing for 2,000 years. So, kind of wake up, yeah? I put this, the irony in the mirror. I've been talking about mirrors. In the next part, I'm going to show you stuff that will either go straight over your head or take it off your shoulders, because no one, to my knowledge, has ever touched on this. There is one autistic savant out there, and he's on the internet. I can't remember his name, but if you put in autistic savant, turns on Einstein's equation, something like that, you'll find him out there. He's saying, I have turned on Einstein's equation. It's like, I'm glad I wasn't there to witness that bit, but you know. So he's turned it on. He says the equation was turned off originally, and to turn it on, you have to rearrange it. And he says in that video three times, nobody out there, go and search it, has ever done this and turned these equations on. I'm the first. Hey, you find this out there in conspiracy world. Everyone's the first to come across stuff that actually I read in a book in the 70s, and it came from like 2,000 years ago anyway. So no one's the first. This has all been known, and everything I'm about to show you has been known too. And I'll touch on proving that to you. The rest you'd have to do for yourself. Point being about the autistic savant is what he's claiming is unique to him, as I say, is not. You can just go out there. In fact, I have the book here, which is, I think, published in 93. This guy wasn't born then. Quoting the formula that he's quoting, and actually taking it one step further. Because he did this formula, he concludes that the world is run by reptiles, and we are controlled through maritime law, and so on. Now, I get the maritime law stuff. I'm not disputing that at all. This is one of the magic spells we'll talk about later. My point is, look in the mirror. What do you see in the mirror? When you look in the mirror, do you see yourself? Do you see yourself as others see you? No. No, you don't. You see the exact reverse of you. Left is right, up is down, whatever, etc. But we'll touch on this in the next bit if we have a 10-minute break or something?
Yeah, quick drink.
We'll make that 15 minutes then, yeah? 20, whatever. Have a quick drink. And then we'll get into some interesting stuff, which actually, I hope, will pin down what I've been struggling with for 20 odd years now. I'm watching a truth movement burgeon and fall apart. And there's a reason it's falling apart, and there's a reason it needs to come together too. So see you in a minute. The irony in the mirror. We live in a time of enlightenment where so many have awoken to a fundamental personal reality. Know thyself is the axiom of all time. We must do this because we realize that what we think in some way creates or helps to create our own reality. This is true. We all know this.
But are we consciously aware of the fact that this is the central element of all mystery and occult schools? And if you are, why are people slagging off the occult? If not, why not? Next slide, please. So, we were warned. Here's from Corpus Hermetica, Asclepius 1. This is Hermes, or Thoth, or if you're Christian, this guy was known as Enoch. There are some whose ungenerous temper grudges men the boon of immortality and will not suffer them to get knowledge of that in which is divine. For speaking as a prophet speaks, I tell you that in after times none will pursue philosophy and singleness of heart, but there will be many who will make philosophy hard to understand and corrupt it with manifold speculations. In this way, by a cunning sort of study, in which philosophy will be mixed with diverse and unintelligible sciences, such as arithmetic, music, and geometry. The student of philosophy, undefiled, ought to direct his attention to the other sciences only so far as he may thereby learn to see and marvel how the returns of the heavenly bodies to their former places, their halts in preordained positions, and the variations of their movements are true reckonings of number. Only so far as learning the measurements of the earth, the depths of the sea, that was untranslatable, of the air, the force of the fire, and the properties, magnitudes, workings, and natures of all material things, he may be led to revere, adore, and praise God's skill and wisdom. And to know the science of music is nothing else than this, to know how all things are ordered, and how God's design is assigned each to its place, for the ordered system in which each and all, by the supreme artist's skill, are wrought together into a single whole, yields a divinely musical harmony, sweet and true beyond all melodious sounds. I tell you then, that the men of after times will be misled by cunning sophists. I'll put a definition there for any who don't know what that is. It's the use of clever but false arguments, especially with the intention of deceiving. And will be turned away from the pure and holy teachings. Holy, of course, meaning knowledge of science and creation, of true philosophy. For to worship God in thought and spirit with singleness of heart, to revere God in all his works, and to give thanks to God, whose will is wholly filled with goodness, this is philosophy unsullied by intrusive cravings for unprofitable knowledge. I'd ask you to define in your own heads what's profitable knowledge and what's unprofitable knowledge. The ratio is about 99-1. The truth movement is caught up very much in unprofitable knowledge. I don't know if anyone's come across the tetrad. This is the centre of Pythagorean geometry and number systems. It's not a lot, I'll say, on this, other than this defines everything in some way. Obviously you have 1, 2, 3, 4. Together they all add up to 10. The tetrad. It defines the dimensions of space. This is the third dimension. Yeah. Third dimension. Fourth dimension. Starting at unity. You split into two, you then have these three add together to make three, and so on. I'm not going to go into that. The tetrad is something that anyone should go and look at and actually understand for themselves as to why this symbol is of real esoteric interest to anybody, and especially when it comes to banking or numbers or base numbers, like base 10, decimal systems and so on. Because without the decimal system, none of what I'm about to show you would ever have been uncovered. Ever. And nature works according to the decimal system, or at least the expansion of all electromagnetic energies does work according to a decimal system. This is a key to that. But I can't take you into this. This talk isn't about the hermetics or the philosophy of the science or anything. I just want to touch on a few key points where hopefully in nearly an hour from now we're going to end up with what I hope will be my point. Could I have the next one, please?
The Hermetic Code. Quick hands up if you've heard of the Hermetic Code or have any idea at all what it means. Right, that's none. What we have here is... Oh, good, thank you. The triple octave. This is where numbers throughout history will trick you. And I can tell you now the Bible and many, many other writings are written using this knowledge. Massively so. And it's a self-proving concept if you go and look at it. Interestingly, in computing, 1 byte was made with 8 bits because it works best. That's the official comment as to why there's 8 bits in a byte. Why do you think it works best? Yeah? Could it be that nature itself is based on 8? Let's see. The Hermetic Code. This claims to define the evolution of everything in existence, be it a thought, a process, a job, a task, anything at all. Everything unfolds according to the octave. You strike the first note, and then it progresses harmonically as these frequencies increase until you get to the end of the octave, and the end of that is the first note of the next octave. I am the beginning and the end, the alpha and the omega, is the same, all right, in musical terms. So if you put 3 octaves together, you would think 3 times 8, 24, but the interesting thing is you've only got 22. And that's because the last note of the octave is also the first note of the second octave and the third octave. So you end up with 22 subdivided by 7, which is the classical definition of pi. That is pi. That's what they're telling you. This is the thing that ties the entire universe together, if you happen to believe what the great ancients actually tell you. It comes in 3 phases, active, passive, and neutral, not necessarily in that order either, and these things are only active, passive, and neutral relative to each other. Okay? So you might think of a project, you might want to, I don't know, write a song, and you do the very first thing, the thought is the first thing. The second thing will actually be getting off your arse and putting pen to paper, or it might be creating words in your head, but at some point you need to put this down. The time when you physically do something, it can all be a thought process, but to bring it into reality, you must do something in 3-dimensional reality at certain points of the evolution of that octave. This is what this science tells you. It's not my interpretation. Now, I put comma here and there. They're actually called Pythagorean commas. This is what Pythagoras sussed. So let's talk about music for a minute. Back then, the musical scales, there was an infinity of notes, not just 12 like we have today. 8 divided into 12 semitones. There was an infinity of notes, and the harmonics of each note didn't have any relationship with the harmonics of other notes. So each note was unique in its own way. And then it was Bach, actually, who actually, we'll touch on this later, created the first ever unified field theory in science by creating music on the well-tempered scale, where there were 12 notes. 8 notes, 12 semitones, and they were adjusted, literally, the harmonics were adjusted so that this note could become a harmonic of any of the other notes, or this one could become a harmonic of any of them. So whatever you play, they're all harmonically related. This is just music theory nowadays. Back then, there was no relationship between the natural harmonics. You couldn't take a note and say it would be a harmonic of that note over there. And they had to adjust this mathematically to make it harmonically usable, so that you could put it on a keyboard or whatever. And indeed, music changed when they did that, because it's a lot easier to use. But I have an interesting recording. There's a great switched on Bach, 1969, Wendy Carlos, or Walter, because he had a sex change later on. First ever electronic musician, synthesizers, creating sounds out of electricity. Incredible album. Did the music of Bach on the old Moog 55 synthesizer. And then, many years later reissued it, the album, done in the non-tempered scale that Bach would have used originally before he used the tempered scale. You have to hear it. This is hermetic music. This is what was used in churches, and it's pure science of sound. These guys know something that you don't, and they know how to even create your thoughts or impressions or manipulate you through the science of sound, which might come as no surprise because everything is sound, as we'll find out if you don't already understand. The point is, though, the key aspect of esoteric history, and all religions are based on this. For example, just when was it? Oh, a couple of weeks ago, a Christian, born again Christian, says to me, "Ha-ha, I know what you're talking about. 666, it's the number of the beast, yeah?" And I said, "Well, why is it the number of the beast?" He said, "Well, cause, and this is the answer to why that's the number of the beast." He says, "Cause the number of Jesus is 777, and he's less than that. So that's why." It's like, "All right, I get it now, thanks." And it's like, oh my God. So in expressing 666, that's pure hermetic occult philosophy, related to me by a Christian who would think I was Satan if I ever dared to suggest that what he just said was actually occult philosophy. And that's the key to the Christian church. It's an entirely occulted church. I learned this by kind of stumbling across it when I was in it years ago. They have this knowledge. Behind the Christian church and behind the other churches, there's always an occult church. And they all know the same stuff, you know, at different levels. The Priory of Zion, the Knights Templar. These are just Christian things. I'm not saying the Knights Templar are not bad, because they are. But like most things, there's two fields to this. Just because they created money doesn't make them wrong, you know? It really doesn't make them wrong. What is wrong is who then stole the esoteric concept and then abused you with it. So anyway, a couple of points I just want to highlight again. 22 notes, not 24, because the middle two are the same here. So it's 24 minus 2 is 22. Subdivided by 7 is pi. The Hermetic code is pi. If you can remember that, it might make things a little easier later on. And the three octaves come either in active, passive, or neutral form, not necessarily in that order. This one, for example, is only active relative to that one. You're sat there rather passively at the moment, but you could suddenly wake up and think that what I just said was rubbish, and you become active and I become passive. Do you see what I mean? The relationships change. And that's how you've got to regard these three, the trinity of creative energies that are there for you to understand. And the whole trinity concept came from this. I have the next one. So, the Pythagorean comment. As the Chinese knew by observation, the circle of fifths was slightly imperfect. This is a musical concept, the black notes on a keyboard, kind of. This means that practical music based on the harmonic series can never be played at optimum frequencies because this natural discrepancy is always there. And it is always there. In three dimensions, it is there. Pythagoras eventually calculated the precise difference and it became known as the Pythagorean comma. You find this in science today. Well, we had a scientist talk to me before. She might have come across that. The uneven periods of development between the fundamental notes of a major scale, which remember goes tone, help me here, tone, semitone. So the progression of the tones, you know, goes up a tone, but then it's retarding. It's not another tone, it's retarding to a semitone. Then it goes to a tone, and another semitone. So at 2 points in an evolving octave, it retards. Okay? So, to put into plain English, if you were to strike a note on a tuning fork, that note will detune itself and disappear. Okay? Going back to the original hermetic kind of system, in theory, not in practice, you strike that and that note would never detune. It's the difference between what they call spiritual, real music, and that which we can make in three dimensions. But it's been calculated. And this actually is the basis of Pythagorean math and everything. So, the uneven periods of development between fundamental notes thus give us an exact picture in musical terms of the mode of progression through space and time of all natural phenomena, great or small, material or otherwise. Just take that on board as a philosophical concept if it doesn't make literal sense to you yet. The same and the other. This is another great esoteric concept. You can't even put into words what this means, but it is the same and the other. The opposite is the same as that. It is opposite too. And these were described in this way. The same was a circle, the other was seven circles. And this was supposed to show the seven, what you just saw before, the hermetic encoding of reality, of nature, of everything, into seven notes of different frequency, seven colours, seven, you name it. This is why Jesus, for example, was given the number 777 and so on. And incidentally, 666 is the evolution of a human being, it's the beast, the number of man. That's all it ever actually meant. You can't evolve beyond six on the hermetic scale. Can't be done until you transcend using the Pythagorean kicks. This is the key to it. The two points where the octave starts to involve, if you physically, in a three-dimensional world, step in and do something, it will keep involving. This is why 2,000 years ago, people, masters of this, did this, and you still hear about them today. Because those stories won't die. They become as part of a part of your reality, just like the chair you sat on. This is the theory behind the science, and the science proves out because we still talk about it. And you can prove this too. And this lies conceptually at the root of what I've been trying to say for years, but never could. I couldn't step up as someone who's pointing out the banking scam and then go into this kind of stuff. But I've very much been involved in it. And would stand and debate it with anyone. As I say, I actually did this stuff. I was 25 years doing Druid research and so on, which is just research. You're all doing it in your own way. Anyway, Plato's mirror. I'll come on to that on the next slide, I think. But the same and the other. These are simply two circles to say that where you have one thing, you have its opposite. And where you have its opposite, you have it's opposite, and yet they're one and the same thing. They're all part of the same octave of creation, whatever it may be. Hard concept, but not really, because all you're doing is talking musical theory here. Oh, this musical theory, of course, was known thousands of years before we actually started using it, so it kind of ties up. Can I have the next one? So, this is looking at the other. Both the same and the other were depicted as circles. The other contains six inner circles. This is the sacred symbol of the Pythagoreans and was regarded as a visual expression of the underlying musical nature of the universe. The intersection of the two brings you the vesica piscis. This actually is the sign of Jesus, the ichthus. I see it on cars, everywhere I go. Again, Christians who would perhaps and do, I don't attack them, but I get attacked by them for being an occultist or a Satanist or not believing in Jesus. I believe in Jesus, all right, just not the one that they're on about. And the one I believe in comes with all the evidence and documentation and logic to go with it. And as you'll see, I'll touch later on clearly who he was. History shows it. Other historical researchers could say, no, it doesn't, or I don't agree. That's great. But it's been known, and it literally lies at the very root of what I went into earlier. You see, in this country alone, there's a group called, well, they don't call themselves anything. I'll come back to that, because I'll drop that just for now. It's dawned on me where I'd be taking it. Anyway, here we have the vesica piscis, the intersection of two circles, and of course this shape is the ichthus, which is the sign of Jesus. Does anyone know what that picture is? There. Yeah, that's a real picture. I just thought I'd throw that in out of interest, because wherever you get conceptual geometry, you'll actually find it in reality too. And this is the point. If you can't see it, and observe it and test it with every function of your body and mind, it's kind of probably not real, all right?
Were you going to... I was going to say, have you seen the Orion Nebula? That kind of...
Yeah. I mean, anyone heard of the electric universe theory?
Yeah.
Yeah? Fine. I've yet to see a scientist who doesn't fall off his chair when you go into that with them. They can't answer it. It's perfectly obvious and self-evident that that is what's happening. There's another science for us to understand. And actually, it is provable. Everything is electricity and the dielectric. There's only two forces in nature. That's it. That's the secret that comes out of all of this. That's the secret that allows them to create money out of nothing as well, and to dupe you into using it the way that you do. Anyway, the Vesica Piscis, I put that on because it's a very Christian thing. I must point out, I'm not attacking Christianity, and I'm not attacking David Icke. I'm attacking your sense of what these things are, all right? In the hope that you'll just think a little further, and hope at some point that you all conclude what I have, and others seem to be now. Next slide, please. The Sierpinski triangle. Anyone heard of this one? This is the geometry of perfect order according to all science, all right? This is what they accept as being the geometry of perfect order. Anyone who's studied fractal stuff will see that that's a fractal image. How would you create that? How would you create it? Can I have the next slide, please? Because it's dead easy and you can do this yourself. And if you go online, there's even, I couldn't believe this when I looked, there's even a little program that runs it for you and shows you everything. You create a triangle. So you're limiting yourself to three dimensions, three aspects. And you start anywhere outside of that triangle. And you then randomly generate the number 1, 2, or 3. This is a random generation. And obviously the first random generation gives 2, because this starting point is going towards the 2. So we throw a 2 on the dice there, and it goes towards 2. But exactly halfway down its route towards where it's going, you throw another dice. And this dice obviously was 1. So you redirect it to 1. And halfway on its way there, now it's within the triangle, and it will never escape it, you throw the dice again, and this time it's come up 3. So you go up there, but halfway, you throw the dice again, and this one was obviously 1, so you come down here. If you do that, if you iterate 500 times, and it does vary, obviously, to 1,000 times, you'll end up with the Sierpinski triangle, the ultimate order in nature, created from a random number generator, albeit limited to 3, but then you live in a three-dimensional reality. So, it's hard to put this concept over, but the scientist's classic example of order is the Sierpinski triangle, and yet you can sit them down and within 2 minutes show how it's created out of random number generation. That really causes a few problems for them. But anyone can do this, and you can go and watch it online because someone's designed a clever little ditty to do it. A little earlier, I was talking on how I got into this stuff and some of the things that I got involved in. This one here really amazed me. It's human spontaneous combustion of all sorts. This secret society had been investigating human spontaneous combustion. Anyone not know what that is? Good. I've got to ask how, why? Why do we know that? Anyway, here's the research paper, or a summary of it, as to, and this is Dr. A.M. Davy. Again, anyone who does their research will have stumbled across that name. They've proved what causes human spontaneous combustion, to the point where they can predict where the next one will be, and then they go along and prove it. Yes. Now, you won't believe that until you see it with your own eyes, so I can't prove that to you here. But a fascinating concept, and particularly because they've actually listed here all the ones that did happen, and some of them that they got to in advance, and so on. Strangely, I need to watch them burn once they've moved them, but that's... I didn't research this, you know what I mean? I'm just going down that track. It's of great interest.
Here's one that lives just down the road from me. A family by the name of Dewar living in Whitley Bay. And this was 1908. So actually I went, and because the Dewars are quite well known in Whitley Bay still, so I went and did a bit of research on that a few years ago. And sure enough, it was a spontaneous human combustion case. So which kind of personally verified for me what this was. Now what it's to do with is the movement of the energy grid around the planet. Has anyone come across the energy grid?
Sorry, Mark, can I just ask you, I'm not sure that I followed you when you said the human combustion, I mean what people...
Spontaneously combust and burn and into dust, yeah. Spontaneously without any ignition source. Yeah, but that's the point, it's not random. Yeah, and they've managed to prove this and they understand what's causing it. Again, it's earth energies and the intersection of earth energies at a certain time based on the alignments. And this has been mathematically proven, scientifically proven. Nobody actually doubts this. Mainstream would, of course. You put that in a newspaper tomorrow, it's like, we wouldn't quite get that, because what do you mean the earth energy grid? The earth energy grid, the public can't really become consciously aware of yet. They're not meant to, but it does exist. And here was proof of it, as I say. Actually, was there a quote that I wanted to read out? And actually involved in this research was Isaac Newton, and as he pointed out, all nature is predictable and therefore can be prevented when it is possible to do so. Human spontaneous combustion is only a very small part in the overall progression of the theory of Earth. And if no one's read Isaac Newton's theory of Earth, I really suggest you do. He was the ultimate alchemist. It's great that most of our science today came from somebody who most scientists today would call insane. It's tremendous. But Newtonian mechanics, well, we can ship most of that down. And I don't mean that arrogantly, because it is right, but it's only part of the picture. And if this technology here doesn't let us down, I'll take you on and show you parts of that picture. Right, here is... there was a book published in 1993. As part of my research, it was back in the late 80s. I'd set up with others the Earth Foundation, and I found myself in a position to get information from all different circles and whatever. We were being sent info, it could have been on the world grid, anything. And if it was of use to, if it was biological information on DNA, we'd pass it over to people who were in that field. That was all we did. That was the point, getting information to where it was best needed. The weakness in that was it was our judgment as to where it was best needed, but you can only do your best. Anyway, I picked up on... I had a friend in Germany who was translating stuff. He said, you've got to see this, don't believe this. And he was right, I didn't. And here I am, 20-odd years later, and I firmly believe it. I've run this past scientists of all schools, and you only get two responses. One is, nope, and they shut off straight away because they realise their entire life's been wasted. Or the other one, I can't repeat. It's mind-blowing. This kind of sums it up, just on the back of his book here. This book is fascinatingly written. The content is mathematically flawless. For the first time in the history of humanity, the scientific studies of Dr. Plichter provide a foundation for our physical worldview. Everything that preceded Plichter, from Newton to Einstein, was only theory. And that's true. They never proved a thing. In fact, Einstein never did. His equation that we're aware of nowadays is simply an abbreviation. And when you look at the long-term formula, you'll see that actually what was missed out of it was the very four-dimensional aspects that we're going to be looking at now, and that I've forgotten his name, but the names, they all go out of my head. The laws of electricity should have picked up on this too, but everything was slightly doctored, and for a very good reason. This guy, incidentally, not a conspiracy theorist, he's a multidisciplinary scientist with top degrees in maths, physics, chemistry, biology, you name it, this guy did it. And
when he presented his papers, his final paper on what we're going to look at now, to his senior university professors and so on, the only response he got from them was, we always knew that one day somebody would come along and show us that everything we knew was wrong and that we would agree with them. So I'm not going to sell this guy's science. What I'm saying is, you go out and look. The book I'm on about is Peter Plichter's God's Secret Formula. I hate the name of the book, and the cover's even more off-putting, but that's the one. Now, Kevin over here bought it a while back. How many reads are you into now?
Six.
Yeah, well, can you sum it up in a sentence as to where you're at with it?
Well, there's so much in there. When you read it first time, like most books, you sort of go through and... the more you read, the deeper it gets, and you understand it. I mean, there's misprints in there that people pick up on.
Yeah, I found another last night, actually.
Yeah, there's a few, but, you know, it's a misprint. But if you read it, there's so much in there, it's fabulous.
What this guy's done is shown that... contrary to all the complex equations that all scientists in all fields of science are using, you could sit in a junior school classroom and learn this stuff. A classic example, I suppose, being the inverse square law that applies in physics and so on. Now, show me a kid who understands the inverse square law, but we'll show you a way where any six-year-old can understand it, because it's simply the addition of uneven numbers. That's all it is. You don't need formula, you just add the uneven numbers together, and any kid can do this. Like, for example, the square of the first three uneven numbers is 3 squared. The square of the first 10 uneven numbers is 10 squared, and so on. If they taught this stuff in school, that reciprocal law that we just talked about would become obvious as to why that works. Because it works because of the numbers, not because some teacher says, this formula works. Do you follow me? It's in the numbers. This guy actually proved that insects, and he did, I read the paper, it's not in the book, proved that insects have no comprehension of the third dimension. This is why they don't fall off of ceilings. Get that? You'll go on, if you look it up, you'll find that they reckon that their legs are so small that they fit into the atomic bonding of the ceiling that they're... No. They just do not perceive and are therefore not subject to three dimensions. That's why you'll never catch a fly unless you're very, very lucky. Anyway, that's just one to take on board. I'm not trying to prove anything there. An insect has no comprehension of the third dimension. Humans are unable to comprehend the fourth. However, because we're conscious of ourselves, we are able to draw logical conclusions from recognized mathematical laws. If there has to be a fourth dimension, this higher and final dimension must have a form of consciousness beyond the bounds of our consciousness. Since the dawn of time, this notion has gone under the name of God. Call it what you will, all right? Call it what you will. We have the next one. Here's back to Corpus Hermeticum, Libellus 4. Prime number crossing the Hermetic code in one passage. This is by Hermes, again in Corpus Hermetica. God is in all things as their root and the source of their being. There is nothing that has not a source, but the source itself springs from nothing but itself, if it is the source of all else. God, then, is like the unit of number, for the unit, being the source of all numbers and the root of them all, contains every number within itself and is contained by none of them. It generates every number and is generated by no other number. What the hell is he writing all this stuff for, like thousands of years ago? Now, everything that is generated is incomplete and divisible and subject to increase and decrease, but that which is complete is subject to none of these things. I'm suggesting that the truth movement is subject to decrease. It will not go on to where we think it will, just on the basis of numbers alone. We have to act according to the Pythagorean kick. This is what your enemy doesn't want you to know, ever. Next one, please. Even the Book of Revelation. Now, you'll see soon when I show you the prime number cross, I won't bother reading through that, but if you do, you'll find that that's actually a brilliant description of what you're about to see. And I could have done a whole ream of these things. There's many references to this about what God actually is. Even just from memory, going back, we have the description of God as literally a geometric figure. That's in the Bible itself. Anyway, next slide, please. And there again, in wisdom, this is in the Bible, but thou arranged all things by measure and number and weight. Are these pretty stories, or are we trying to be told something? Because they're not pretty stories. They got buried up and a lot of them changed and so on, but the scribes who altered the Bible according to the instructions from the people who were writing it did not alter this stuff. Couldn't really. There it is, it speaks for itself. Next one. There's the prime number cross. Now at the top it says the space mirror. It's actually off screen and I've put it upside down, which else is why I put the David Bowie comment earlier upside down as well. The space mirror. This is the prime number cross. Do you know that they have not to this day sussed the sequence, where's my scientist friend? The sequence of prime numbers. In fact, it's the greatest mathematical mystery. In fact, they encode all missiles, you know, nuclear missiles, etc., with prime numbers, because you can't crack it. A computer would take years, if I put a number before it, it would take years to work out whether it was prime or not. So, if you set that as the entry task, it's pretty damn secure. I would point out to those who research this kind of thing, anyone in the room aware that a lot of military weaponry has been turned off in the last number of years and reported as such, but there's no apparent cause for it? Anyone aware of that at all? Some say it's aliens, others say it, whatever. It could well be any of the above, but this knowledge became fully available in let's just say at the time that these things, the report of these things actually started. So, could be aliens, could be someone with this knowledge. Ponder. The prime number cross. Now, I'm not going to go into this in detail, because as you've seen, this guy's read six books, or read it six times so far, and there's a whole lifetime there. It really takes you to places that you can't imagine, as you might expect if this happened to be the ultimate secret of the Illuminati. What do the Illuminati believe in? And I use the word Illuminati loosely. I don't mean, well, whatever. What do they believe in? Does anyone know?
A higher power.
Yeah?
Control.
No, they don't. No, not necessarily. That's what comes out of what they've done. But what are they actually? You were right. Yeah, they believe in, I think you said,
a higher power.
A higher power. What's that higher power?
Knowledge.
What was that?
Knowledge.
They actually state it, believe it or not, the Illuminati, there's four of them in the UK, that's all. They're not the baddies you're chasing, by the way, but that's another issue. If you ask any Illuminatus throughout history, there's no exceptions, what is God, in their opinion, and they would say the only reality is numbers. Everything else is illusion. What did David Sykes say was real? And everything else is illusion?
Love.
Love, that was it. Right. So.
Love
and positive. Yeah. So. I know it would sound trite of me to say, can you prove love? But you can prove numbers. It doesn't really matter, because this actually is love. I'm not denying any of that stuff whatsoever. What I am pointing out is that the Illuminati, and you must do this if you can go and find them. You don't have to though. Ask the esoteric schools. Ask a Pythagorean mathematician. Ask a senior Freemason what they understand God to be. Number is what they'll say. Numbers are the only reality, and a true Illuminist would say only that. Numbers are everything, nothing else. That's it. Numbers make everything. Numbers are the only reality in the universe. So, what I'm about to show you actually proves that your Illuminati are right. And this should actually ring, hopefully, a tone with those who have studied who the Illuminati are. The church would say, numbers? That's terrible. with Jesus, or God is the top here, and only through Jesus can you get there. And well, actually, this is what Jesus taught. Give me 2 hours, I'll prove it to you. It's all actually there. He taught Pythagorean math. We will touch on that as we move on. But I'd like to point out on here, the prime numbers, the circles, if you can imagine that they actually spiral, yeah? They spiral, but I can't put a spiral in a picture. It took to CAD. I love a good version of this, mate, but this took ages. Is, first circle, all the numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's obvious it goes around in a 24-hour clock, the 24-hour clock invented by the Egyptians originally. It tells you in the Bible also to not to put endless streams of numbers together, but to put them in a circle. I can't quote that one because I couldn't find the damn thing, but it is there. So, if you do that, you go around. Now, the numbers on the first circle total 300. Oh, damn it. I've got it on later streams. We'll get into that. I won't go into the math now. The point being, these are the prime numbers. Look where they lay when you put them in a circle. Far from being a random pattern, what do you call that pattern? If I were to draw it in, you'd actually find this is the cross of the Knights Templar. Then I'll tell you now, this is where it came from. So when you get 15 or 16 different interpretations of what their symbology means, this will take you right to the root of it. And I'll tell you, there's not many, and not that I've met many, I don't want to give the wrong impression here, but if I was to meet these great occult masters in the Freemasons here and now, they wouldn't have even touched on this. They've been looking for this. And only some of them have found it. And the writer of this book gave it to them. He gave it to the Jesuits. And he explains in his book why he had to publish it for the public in an understandable form. But this has to be out there. No one has picked up on it. You Google this, you'll get nothing. What's the chances of that? Go and find it. Anyway, so you will find in coming years people will be talking about this because it's a self-proving, and as Plichter himself says, there is not a human mind on this planet that can dispute anything about this. And I've never been able to. I've come across scientists who say, yeah, I can, oh no, I can't. You know, they'll dispute it and then realise how silly they've been. This is indisputable. This is a challenge I'm putting out to you all. If the Illuminati believe numbers are the only reality, here is the proof of that, which they've been looking for, yeah, and could only have got in the late 80s, when I was picking up on the scientists' work then. They could have only have had it since then. But you'll see what it allows them to do. Numbers are the only reality. There is a pattern to the prime numbers. Prime numbers is music. Everyone who looks into this knows that music is based on the primes. They call it the music of the primes. It's there. And I started this by pointing out that music is actually the physical creation of all matter and so on. What you have with the prime number cross is how things are created, brought into three dimensions, and how the electromagnetic extrudes in four dimensions throughout an ever-expanding circle. And it's at that point that I can't take you into that, and I could do if I did a 3-hour presentation on that alone, we'd take the tops of your head off. It's incredible. So I'll just touch on it for now. On space matter in the prime number cross, space around an atomic nucleus contains the dimensions 2^4. I'd expected the prime number cross to somehow be connected to matter. It's not only somehow connected with matter, but each individual atom contains the information and structure of the prime number space. I was shaken to the core with this discovery. I realised that the inversion of a four-dimensional geometry, which is derived from the base numbers 1, 2 and 3, that's your trinity, and which has 8 rays, that's your hermetic code, must again produce a geometry which is constructed on the numbers 1, 2 and 3, and is triangular. The geometric form must moreover be triangular and can only be illustrated by a hexagonal honeycomb form. I thus discovered the reciprocal geometry of the prime number cross. This is the Star of David, the interlocked tetrahedra. Anybody who's looking into Richard Hoagland's work will
have come across the interlocked tetrahedra as being the central symbology of that physics. There it is. And of course that became the Star of David. There's no pattern to primes, is there? Really, that's what they've been looking for. Strange how every prime number sits either side of a multiple of 6. And go and find me an exception, and you will. You will find exceptions, but there's something special about those exceptions which kind of proves the point. All exceptions are squares of previous prime numbers. Every prime number sits around the number 6 or a multiple of it. And this was the great, this is, if you can follow this, this is how he cracked the entire prime number problem. Because there's only 3 numbers that create everything, and think of a number as a unit, not 3 is 1 happening 3 times, 2 is 1 thing happening twice. Do you see what I mean? It's not a defined number in its own right. 1 times 2 times 3 equals 6, but uniquely add them together and you get the same. This forms the network around which all prime numbers create, and 6, you're going into your number of man and so on. But, as I say, this is known, and it takes the whole talk just to get into that. 6 is the key factor. All primes reside either side of the factors, so they're either +1 or -1, either side of the number 6, or anything, or any multiple of 6. I have the next one. The circles expand, so if you add up the numbers in each circle, first one is 300, next one is 9, 15, 21. It's noted that these are factors, taking the first circle as the 300 base unit, factors of the odd numbers, going up, increasing in number all the way. Over the uneven numbers, the total of the first and second circle is 300 squared. So, again, there was always the danger of putting numbers here that it scares people, so we won't really get lost in this. If you look at it, you'll come across something quite incredible. As I say, no scientist from any field has been able to shoot down or do anything other than walk away from, in my experience. It frightens them. By these square numbers, the number of electron twins on the atomic shell also increases. Fact. Observed fact. The 4 prime twins on the first shell determine the structure of all the other shells and demand a zero shell on which only the numbers +1 and -1 are located. It's formerly been a complete mystery why the atomic shells have to have a lower shell on which only 2 electrons are located. Well, he's proven why that is as well. Because there are 2 forms of space, there must also be a life form for each space prescribed by the mathematics. Take that one on board, guys. Go ponder. You have 2 space either side of the mirror, and there must be a life form for each. And he actually goes on to prove this as well. Anyone thinking archons here? Because you need to be slightly later on. Because infinity has a triple nature, space, time and number, there's only 3 infinities and that's them, the numbers themselves evolve on the basis of the first 3 numbers. Every number is made up of 1, 2, and 3. Every other number comes from 1, 2, and 3. The primes come from applying -1 and 1 to the multiples of those numbers. Where is it? Yeah. I had discovered the error in reasoning which we make when we speak of the speed of light of an electromagnetic wave. I was reading a paper just last week saying this guy, scientist, I think, I can't recall all the detail, had realized that actually when we're looking out into space using a telescope and seeing things like so many light years away, he's asked the simple question, how is that? How can we do that? Because the bigger you build the telescope, yeah, all you're doing is capturing more of that light and intensifying it into a single point so that it might form and you can see it. But if that light isn't there in the first place, because it's retarded, it's gone so far, it does decrease according to the inverse square law, how can we actually, if we can't see it, how can the telescope see it, is the point he's making. And if you follow that simple question through, you realise that actually there's not a telescope on the planet that can see more than 300 times further than your eyes can. Yeah,
In that shock. Ponder it though. Go ponder that one. Which actually changes everything, because you're not looking light years out there, are you? If you take next slide, please. So he calls the prime number across the space mirror. And you can do this. You can actually do this. I've seen it done, and we're hopefully going to knock one up for demonstration. But Plato describes a mirror. Basically, you put two mirrors together at 90 degrees. If you sit in front of it, you get three images. The left, the right, and the middle. The middle one is you. Literally, it's not the reverse of you. It's you. You're seeing yourself for the first time ever as other people see you. However, if you sit there and meditate, you also see your thoughts materializing in that space between the two mirrors, as will people behind you. Done this, seen it, can't prove it, but go do it. Here's the scientific thing, and Plato even talked about it then. Point is, what does that tell you? Once you prove that to yourself, what does that tell you about reality that you live in? What it tells you is it's x squared, y squared geometry. And that, anyone scientifically minded can go on and kind of work out an awful lot from there, but we'll come back to that one. So the space mirror makes it possible to see a hidden phenomena such as a mental picture or an idea. I know that's a profound statement. This is coming from a top scientist, multidisciplinary scientist, who's done it, and I've done it too, with others. So it does work, go and do it. And if you want to know how, it's in Plato's Timaeus, he describes how to do it. The four-dimensional infinite space around a point does not possess a z-axis, but only x squared, y squared geometry. This notion has nothing to do with three dimensions of space or one dimension of time. It's true, four-dimensional space. Infinite empty space always has a quadruple structure because the world is two-dimensional squared at every point. And as I say, this cross itself is based on a form that he recognised as being the cross of the Order of Christian Knights. It's literally the Templar cross. Next slide, please. Space and matter, again going back to Corpus Hermetica, the existence of all things that are would have been impossible if space had not existed as an antecedent condition for their being. If anything is to exist, space for it must be provided beforehand, blah, blah, blah. Richter says that in his book. What he's proving is that it's the structure of space itself that demands it be filled by matter. The structure itself. And he proves this in a way that you'll only get if you go and read the book. Next slide, please. Again, more on the prime number cross. If there's one thing you do today is make a note of Peter Plichter, prime number cross, go and get the book and just go into it. It will take you off into different realms and you might wake up to what these people know at the top. Coming back to numbers. Yeah, the gas medium with its reciprocal numerical order, this is all stuff he's proved within his book, manages the transmission of music according to a fractal system containing eight stages. You know, when you make a sound, like you're hearing me now because there's a compression wave coming through the air, isn't there? But if you ask a scientist, what is the air? It's a random collision of molecules. So at what point do trillions of molecules actually transmit my voice to you? How can you hear that? The theory doesn't stand up to logic or anything. You shouldn't hear me if their theory of random gas molecules is correct, which it apparently seems to be. So there has to be another mechanism at work. And once he worked out that it has to be a fractal mechanism using prime number space, as he calls it, it was then proven that the ear does actually have a digital receptor in it. Scientists came across this separately within a year of him saying this. But you must go and look at that for yourself. It should be emphasized once again that two physical spaces have to exist. The four-dimensional space around a point transports electromagnetic waves according to the order of whole numbers. If a three-dimensional body is filled with air in such a four-dimensional space, this air will transport heat or sound according to the order of the reciprocal numbers. Reciprocal numbers being whole numbers under one. So two becomes a half, three becomes a third, four becomes a quarter, five becomes a fifth. That's reciprocating the number, and it's the secret to hermetic and occult science, I can assure you. Both spaces are pure inversions, since for each whole number, the infinite space, infinite reciprocal value also exists.
Both numbers or types of space are formed on 1, 2 and 3 and the structural number 8. I'll move beyond this anyway. So what's so special about the moon? And whoever becomes aware of the relationship between this astronomical data of the Earth and of the moon will know that two heavenly bodies are mathematically linked with the greatest degree of precision. And because nobody was present to form these spheres with his hands, to bring them to the correct distance and start them at reciprocal order, orbiting numbers, the only explanation left is that nature is intelligent and we are self-reflection creatures, or the self-realization of that intelligence. Or were they present, that is? Could someone have put the moon there? Who knows? Leave you to ponder that one, but oh, that picture, by the way, is a pyramid on the moon. But there's many of them. This is another one, Iapetus. I think many people have seen these pictures nowadays. This is Iapetus, as discovered by NASA. This was discovered as hundreds of thousands of years old, and many of them were found. And this, of course, is the Death Star from Star Wars. And the Russian Space Agency has actually officially declared that as a non-natural object, and they've just recently done that to our moon as well. They declare it as a non-natural object. So this isn't idiocy as such. This is very real stuff and a very real history. I mean, what was this? Could it be a kiddie's toy based on that? Who knows? But they were found in rock strata. I'm saying hundreds of thousands. I actually think it was millions, but I don't have the data with me. It's a well-known concept. let's freak out in the Moon Age daydream. I had to get Mick Ronson in there. Greatest guitarist in history for me. Absolute zero, -273.2 degrees. Sidereal month, 27.32 days. Ratio of the corner cap of the square to the circle. So if you put a circle in a square and fold the corner cap down, the ratio is 2732. Now I was talking about squaring the circle, aren't they, these Freemasons? But I've never met one who knows the 2732 number. Never mind, they'll get there one day. Reciprocal geometric lock is 1 over 2732. That's 366. That's why the Earth goes around the Sun in 366 days, which it does if you stand off the planet. If you're on it, it's 365 and a quarter. Statistical average female hormone cycle, in my experience, is every 2 hours, but apparently it's... oh dear, here we go again. Apparently it's 27.32 days. The ratio 4 to pi is 1.2732. The moon acceleration to Earth, 0.273. That would be found to be 0.272, I'm quite sure. The radius of the moon is... Yes, it's that 2732 number again. And Professor Tom proved in this document here that I would have gone through at the start, proved that ancient man used the megalithic yard of 2.732 feet in the construction of the global grid. Gas incidentally expands by 1 to 730.2 of its volume for every 1 degree. So is this coincidence? And I could have gone on. Is this coincidence? And it's not. Next one, if we can possibly use it. I'm going to have to skip a number of things I've prepared here, because I'm not really interested in taking you into the science. What I'm trying to get is that many years ago, I was in finance and realized something was going on. I was threatened for asking too many questions, but, you know, shit happens, doesn't it? And I went on from there and I learned an awful lot more about it. I also became involved in the occult studies that these people, it turns out, were very much involved in. And had some great times, incidentally, as I was telling someone earlier, with the Led Zepp boys being... Yes, we had some good times down in Blackburn. But all that kind of thing. Meeting great people, learning lots of stuff. And it brought me to a realization. When David Icke came along and I supported him and many others start speaking about what's really going on behind the scenes. And as time's gone on, I'm thinking what's really going on behind the scenes is being misreported by a number of people out there who have the eye of the truth movement. Simple as that. So I approached them. The Bradbury Pound is a classic example. I've actually been out tromping 400 doors, putting leaflets through, organised a public meeting to talk about the Bradbury Pound, which is a financial solution that we all need to consider. I have leaflets here from UK Column, and
The lady here has other information as well. So please donate to the UK column on that. Point being that in letting the UK column were approached by a researcher who said, oh, I'm a whistleblower from the Bank of England. I've got this information for you about the Bradbury Pound. The information he had, I already had as a young teenager when I was researching this, and it all came actually from the war diaries of Lloyd George, so you can go and check that out for yourself. It's all in there. A whole chapter called, from memory, How We Saved the Global Economy. I think that was the name of the chapter, so you can't miss it. And it points out in there that the Bradbury Pound was actually used to remove the gold standard. Now, at no point do UK column or anyone else mention that. My question to them is, why not? And that's it. I leave that one hanging. For someone to come along and say, I'm a whistleblower and I'm giving you this information, it just strikes me as a bit strange when I already knew this and I already told these guys 5 years before all of that. But they don't seem to want to know. I ask my question again. When do we all come together and share this knowledge and actually go do something about it? I'll leap beyond this. The point being that elements 43 and 61 do not exist in nature. And this is what he proved with the prime numbers. He's decoded the entire elemental table, and you would call it alchemy. Literally, how one element becomes another. This is done. This is history. This is 1993. So, again, there's not a human mind here can challenge this. I'm not taking you into the detail of it. Go do it. Challenge it. But come to the realization that your Illuminati are right, your churches and religions are wrong, and here's your proof. But the irony is that all the churches and religions put this in their written stuff anyway. They just don't point it out to you. It's all there. Could we have the next one? Nassim Haramein, he's a contemporary physicist and visionary, and he's presented a unified field theory on four-dimensional geometric functions, which defines the other side of the reciprocal mirror, which proven by Plichter. What I'm saying is the prime number cross actually unifies Haramein's geometry and actually explains everything there. So this will be passed on to, it's actually being passed on to, but it won't change anything because it's equally as proven as what he's talking about. The two things just sit together nicely. Go and look at Nassim Haramein if you want to see some wonderful stuff like how a particle can be a wave and a particle at the same time. He'll show you in real life how that can be. And when you see it with your own eyes, it's like, well, what are the physicists been debating about then? Next one. On evil. It was beyond God's power to put a stop to evil and expel it from the universe. This was Corpus Hermetica. Basically what it's saying is that we have the gifts of humanity to actually sort out what is evil and move beyond it. Can I have the next one? Lucifer. Did you know that the Roman Catholic Church has a telescope called Lucifer? Yeah?
Yeah.
And it's absolutely amazing. Do you know what Lucifer stands for?
Light bringer.
Yeah, it was Venus, actually, originally. The light bringer, you're dead right. But I was actually on about the acronym there. Do you know what Lucifer stands for?
There it is.
It is the large binocular telescope near infrared utility with camera and integral field unit for extragalactic research. What? Talk about, you know, they've stretched that completely. They wanted to call that Lucifer. That's the end of it. Next one. So are they magicians, sorcerers, or alchemists in charge of all this? Well, a magician is a shaman, and I've never met a bad one, ever. A sorcerer, met a few of them, that's a subset of magician, and they specialise in manipulating the will, advertising, marketing, sigils, logos, and memes. An alchemist is applied shamanic practice. We need to do this as a truth movement. We need to apply the shamanic practice that we've learned. If we don't, I don't see a future. And they, who some call the Illuminati, I would call Jesuit and are sorcerers of the highest orders, but sorcerers nonetheless. They're not the true magi, nor are they the true alchemists, but mere impersonators. And their sorcery is flawed by their greed, and we can unwind it using that. Self-actualization is actually misrepresented as self-empowerment. You know your self-empowerment movements in the New Age? All designed to misrepresent self-actuation. Next one. skipping through these. So, memes and memetics. A guy called Richard Brody has written a book called Virus of the Mind. He's the guy who created Microsoft Word. He's quite a genius. And his comment on this is that your thoughts are not always your own original ideas. You catch thoughts, you get infected by them, both directly by other people and indirectly from viruses of the mind. Real science under this. Next one. So, moving to finance, we're trying to creep this alchemy into finance. There's two systems exist. The two systems where money is created by a private monopoly in limited supply, or where money is created by the state as a receipt for goods and services against the warehouse of that nation, the value of that nation, and is debt-free. These are the two systems that have contended with each other throughout history. So the system of money is closed, and there is never as much money in circulation as there is debt, and hence scarcity becomes the order of the day. Many of you in here know this now, yeah? The latter system is open and can expand as the economy grows. What we need is an open financial system, and it's quite easy to attain. In terms of an analogy to physics, the former system can never function at over unity, whereas the latter system, it must function at over unity. Just as anyone who's researching energy science nowadays realizes that actually true energy runs at over unity and not less than. And we're talking Tesla and so on there. So money and energy, very much the same physics system. Coming back to Bach, the well-tempered clavier, or to put it bluntly, well-tampered with, rather than each note now having its own unique home, and this is in his book, by the way, about banksters, this is Farrell's book, having its own unique harmonic series which did not overlap with the other notes, each note now could function as a harmonic of any other note. This, and not Maxwell's electromagnetic theory, was the first unification of physics. Moving further into money, there's only a number of these, so we can skip a lot, but the study of money above all other fields in economics is one in which complexity is used to describe truth, or to evade truth, not to reveal it. And the process by which banks create money is so simple, the mind is repelled. With something so important, a deeper mystery seems only decent, and there is a deeper mystery. Next one. Oh, wow, these were the random. Hey, that went past my house. That is what went past my house. Just out of interest, but it really shouldn't have been here. Next one. That's what hit the time bridge where we live. And the next one. Okay, I did say it was random. I'd like to just come back into money in a minute, but I'll go off at a tangent because I have to run with this for the next 5 minutes and close it up, all right? This is a picture of a hurricane. Look at the eye in the middle of it. Interesting. I've heard a lot of people going on about 9/11 and Judy Wood and thermite and whatever. I stumbled across something which I'm only going to utter today, but I think I'll watch it unfold in the next couple of years. Next one, please. This appeared in the middle of Hurricane Wilma, and number two, live on television as it was going. It freaked people, and that was real. And soon after that, Hurricane Wilma then did this on the next slide. It formed into two eyes, which doesn't happen. And the next one, this is from Rosicrucian teacher literature. Again, the pyramid, the tetrad, built on the pyramid, and someone sketched this thing coming out the top. Now, if anyone ever does research into John Dee, Dr. John Dee, you'll find that actually out of the Voynich manuscripts and so on comes basically what I understand to be the science of the vortex. All right, so my crazy theory, because I have none other than this one, is that when people are looking for what happened on 9/11, you do know about the tornado that appeared. Is everyone up on Hurricane Erin? Is it Erin? Yeah. And people are saying, well, what relevance did that have? I have not been able to find a single example of occult history where they were not summoning an energy or a vortex energy. This is actually what was documented back in the 1600s. So I'm very interested in if that was a ritual, which I'm convinced it was, but that's someone else's story. If it was a ritual, what were they invoking?
Yeah, because they invoked something that day. And some people are trying to suggest that it was actually just there randomly. But there you go. Next one. Heart began in 93 when this book came out, by the way. Next one. Prime number cryptography. Prime numbers are used in coding systems by banks, insurance companies, and so on. He's implying that since this discovery, this is no longer true. Okay, so there is no such thing as a secure code anywhere now. And I would suggest it wasn't ETs turning off weapons systems. I would say it was people with this technology. Next one. The Barbary glyph. Anyone seen this one? Next slide. Whoever was behind the Barbary glyph is quite familiar with Western esoteric, Kabbalistic and Hermetic tradition, but also with techniques of higher dimensional projective geometry. As if this were not enough to convince even the hardest skeptic that extraordinary esoteric and mathematical knowledge is used, all encoded in a multi-layered sigil, there is one final thing to be noted. It also encodes the Pythagorean tetrad, and it does, but I don't have time to go into that either. That was another one that slipped in when I was doing my million things. But that actually is just an overexposure, which when de-exposed, another pyramid appears. If we can go on. And that was part of the thing. This leads us into money. A lot of people have come across this. When Judea declared war against the Germans, the Nazis, did you know that? Yeah. Actually, but they didn't declare war. This is just a myth in the truth movement. That was, it explains in that paper article there what they actually did. But they actually boycotted all German goods, all goods, exports and so on. Germany responded by boycotting Jewish shops for one day. That's what came out of that. They didn't declare war, but they effectively did. And that actually is going to lead into what I've used for my money talk. So the next slide should be, yes, and the next one. Oh, pyramid scheme. So this is the key point. I'm going to wind up 5 minutes on this. Because I've talked about finance before. If you haven't sussed now that the people behind this truly know something that you don't, and they're not going to give it up. They are not going to give it up. So if you think the truth movement's going to get through to them, trust me, they're not. They'll kill you before that happens. So we have to think our way through this. And we have the key to do it. I'm happy to talk more on it, but we are running out of time. Fractional reserve or loan to deposit ratio. Truth movement is being told, fractional reserve banking is terrible, it's awful. Well, it's actually what created all the wealth that the West has enjoyed. And the reality of that is that out of that wealth that was created using that system, 99.9% of that wealth was sucked off by the scum at the top anyway. So we didn't benefit from it. I'm not suggesting that much, but we did. You're sat here, you have nice houses and a middle class Western lifestyle, in inverted commas, whatever that means. Fractional reserve, it's a very simple process. It's called fractional reserve because if you lend money out, you put enough in reserves so that once you've done that a few times, the original investment is backed by reserves. If you use that process for yourself, this we can prosper tremendously, there's no doubt about it. But it must be managed, it always was managed, and it is a great wealth creator. But there's this myth being put out there that fractional reserve is the great evil. I'm not saying it's good, because it's very questionable as to whether you should do that at all, taking in a deposit and then lending it out 10 times over. But if you do, if you lend it out multiple times, you actually get back in terms of reserves, enough money to keep your financial institution going. It's all balanced. And the problem is, it only falls down when the banks lend out a loan-to-deposit ratio in excess of 100%. Now, to me, this is the key and the misrepresentation within the truth movement. We can use this for ourselves, right? And it's the loan-to-deposit ratio that was the killer. The second you move over, so if you invest 10,000 with my bank today, I could then lend that out, 90% of it. I must put 10% in reserves. So I could lend 9,000 out. The truth is that instead of just taking that 9,000, I could then lend 11. I could lend more than the 100% of what I've got. If you do that, you need to take money out of reserve to do it, which collapses the entire system. It's like a kid's money box.
It's that simple. So it's the loan-to-deposit ratio that's been the killer here. And the laws are in place to stop that, because anything over a one unity ratio is a pyramid scheme, defined legally. The banks and our leaders allowed this to happen. They actually schemed to increase that. Damn it, I was working with Northern Rock when they were doing 273%, not just 100. So this was schemed and planned, and these people have broken the law, so they can actually all be locked up, so that the next generation of bankers think, hang on, we're not going to do that again. The whole scam, I believe, is to make you look at fractional reserve, which they're happy to virtually get rid of anyway. They've never needed it. Once you start benefiting from it, they don't want really to get involved in it. So they'll drop fractional reserve. It's the loan-to-deposit ratio at each lending. And I go through this in more detail, given more time. Next one. There's the deposit ratios. You should never cross 100%. Look at them. Northern Rock, 322.58%. No surprise they went under first. Is this the Jews behind the economic collapse, by the way? The Jewish banking system?
Usury. Where, yeah. Where's the usury? You're not mentioning the usury.
Usury,
yet.
The charging of interest. I could do. It's not needed. We can remove interest tomorrow.
It is needed.
We can remove interest tomorrow, but I wouldn't personally do that. Because it's about getting through to the system. I had this one with Mike Montagna. Have you come across him as mathematically perfected economy? Oh, well, I agree with you. I shut him down on that. We would use interest, but I would get rid of just about all of it. Next slide, please. That's how fractional reserve works. You issue bonds to the... Well, the government issues bonds. The bank lends out 90% of the money. You spend the money. Seller deposits the money into the bank, and you just start it all over again. That's fractional reserve banking. We can remove interest, it's entirely unnecessary, but if we do that tomorrow, it would create some real issues, and we need to work that one through. That's my understanding. Next one. So, which door leads to justice? Just coming back to this question. If you have two doors and two gatekeepers, and one always lies and one always tells the truth, you go up to one and you say, if I was to ask your colleague here, which is the door to death, what would you say? And whatever answer you get from whichever one you've asked, you go through the opposite door. It's just the logical reasoning. If there was only one guard at the door, you could ask him and theoretically create the other guard. So pose the question as if there were an imaginary colleague there. I've said for years we need to go and take our leaders on and actually ask them a question about banking. One that's rhetorical and they cannot defend in any way or form, but instead, I found that the resources of the truth movement have been spread out, wasted. Yeah. We're not coming together. Could I go to the next slide? There's a long-known system of management for coming together. I'll need to skip through this. Dewey and Dakin, the cycles of prediction, back in the 30s. Anyone know about that? All cycles were predicted and mapped to the stars then. It's scientifically proven. Next one. The Gaussian copula formula that was used to collapse the British economy. I'd love to have gone into that because it's fun. The next one, the Bradbury pound. Please pick up leaflets here. The Bradbury pound is a credit currency, credit note currency. It's not issued as a debt, and this is the part of the solution to the issues we've got, and we must get out of it. You've heard my reserves about the Bradbury pound. Those who are pushing this don't seem to be fully in the picture as to how it works or any of the detail. So I've got reservations, but I back this campaign because this is the only way to go. Glass-Steagall and the next one, please. Separates the investment banking wing from the standard banking. That must be done. And once we've separated them, you keep the standard banking there and the investment banking wing you put up against the wall. And if anyone's got a machine gun, I'll let you do the rest. Some go, oh no, you can't do that. I'm saying it's going to actually come to that if we don't do something. I'm trying to stop a revolution. Next one. The people versus the banksters. It's a shame that's in the way, because it says there that this problem has gone down through the centuries. Lord Acton says it will have to be fought someday, the people versus the bankers. And I was going into solutions there. You know what? I think I'll I kind of have to wind it up here because we are running out of time, but I have details on the solution as to what we must do, how we can come together. If we could just click the next frame, we're not going to see it. Michael Tazarian, you can't see it here, but he's recently said, we must go and ask the right question. When I said this to him 4 years ago, we didn't get that concept, but now he's getting it. Others seem to be, and they seem to be coming to a similar conclusion. We must unify. I like the word coalesce, to act consciously and with intent to provide our own Pythagorean comma in this Jesuit octave of resonance. I'm afraid I'm saying Jesuit. That is who I understand them to be, and I have absolutely no doubt on that. But even that is oversimplified. It does kind of go a little bit beyond that. Next one. This is Gurdjieff talking about action again and how you must go about it. It's all about the Pythagorean comma. Things don't just evolve. You must step in at certain defined points in its evolution. If you don't, it will evolve. In other words, we'll collapse. We need to make sure this goes on. And this science has always been there. It's the science that they use to stuff you with. Next one. Myths of behavioural change. I wish I could remember these. I can't actually see that. Information is not enough. They say information is enough. It's not. It's simply not enough. The other myth is that, I can't read it, my head's not there, so without that I won't even go into it. But the three myths actually of behavioural change, provable nonsense nowadays. We go about changing behaviour by changing action, and behaviour follows action. Just like CO2 follows an increase in temperature, not the other way around. Science proves that. Go and ask David Bellamy, he'll tell you in great detail. Next one. Oh, there it is. Well, my solution to how this entire truth movement can come together and actually take on the correct enemy in the correct way at the correct time is all covered out there. You can't see it. So I can't even talk you through it. But this stuff can be made available, I think, later on.
It will be.
And the next one? That's the definition of the spiral model. Basically, the system to use as a spiral model. We come together as one organization, no leaders, but specific intent. And by God, using this model, which is used for very complex computing problems, it will work. But that's what I'm putting forward as a proposal to the entire truth movement. Rather than, and tell me I'm wrong here, but I've heard 20 people in the last 6 months saying, we've got to come together, and 20 people saying, no, it's the last thing we need to do. All right, so let's do it. How are we going to come together? And when we do, what are we going to do? Are we going to protest about paedophiles, about this, about that? Or are we actually going to go and do something? And highlight the great question that they can't answer. We must ask the question, and that is my point. I wish I could have gone into it in a bit more detail. Can you put the last slide on? I think there is one. No, that's just the banking stuff. I've got 100 quotes there on banking. So anyway, unless you have any questions, that's kind of me done. The whole point is, the enemy, whoever they are, have a system that clearly works. It's been imposed on you for long before you were born. They do exist. I've touched on the edges of it. I don't like that at all. These people are not good. And even if you think we're going to solve these problems, we're not. It's as simple as that. Unless we actually engage it, they expect you to fail. They want you to rise up. We've all heard this. We all know this. What they don't expect is a movement to stand up and take them on using their own knowledge and their own techniques in full public view. They do not expect that, and they will collapse the moment it happens, I'm sure. That's what I'm driving for, anyway. Thank you very much for listening.